All right, now we are live. Welcome to anybody that's watching this. This is the What Do I Know About Actual Play series of videos. I'm Jared Rasher. I have the What Do I Know Games and Geekdom blog. Currently, this stream, we are playing Shadow of the Demon Lord. This is our second session, so if you want to see all of the longer introductions and the explanations, go back and watch the first video. We have novice tier adventuring going on here, and I'm just going to jump straight into introducing people this time around, and we'll go with Ryan, who I have played with for quite a while. Who are you, and who are you playing?
I am the Clockwork Teapot. He may or may not have murderer as one of his professions, and a lot of his background is shrouded in mystery from most of the team thus far.
All right. And then we will go to Steve, who I have also played with for a while. Steve, who are you and who are you playing?
I am, you know, I've gamed with you for forever, and I am playing Abigail Tuller, our priestess of witchcraft and prostitute on the side.
All right. And Jason Hobbs. Plug what you would like to about yourself, because you're internet famous.
Internet famous? I don't know about that. Well, anyway, I'm Jason Hobbs. I'm the host of Hobbs and Friends of the OSR podcast. I'm playing Kane Smith, a redemption-seeking human guy, I guess. There you go.
All right. Mike, introduce yourself, because you're designer famous.
Oh, it's such a lauded title. I'm a freelance RPG game designer that lives in Pittsburgh with a woman and two cats. You can see all my stuff at mikemiler.com and get lots of free stuff. So go there and look. I'm playing Fringe, a sort of amnesiatic changeling.
All right. And finally, last but not least, Kevin, you are also internet famous. Go ahead and introduce yourself and your character.
Hi, I'm Kevin Madison. I'm the host of the Dungeon Musings YouTube channel, and I am playing Vignus Magnuson, who is a Jotun, so kind of a half-giant former thrall. So he's a former slave, ex-bouncer now, and we'll see what happened to him in the meantime. Come on, living in an alley.
All right, so what we're going to do now is I'm using the optional rules for downtime. So what happens when you do that? You roll on a chart and you see what happened to the characters in the time in between sessions. In this case, we're going to take off about a year in between their zero level adventure and their first level adventure to give them time to actually have learned things. So we're going to go through one by one. We're going to find out how they learned their trade that they're going to have at first level. We'll go through what happened to them in their downtime, and if it's not already prescribed in the downtime, we're going to see what kind of living arrangements they have at the end of this. So, we are going to start with Teapot.
Yes.
Teapot, you uncovered a plot in the city at some point in time, which helped many of the people. So, you will get a plus one boon on any social attacks that you make for this session.
Oh, that will round out the...
Yes, the screaming faces and the laughing children, or the screaming, crying children whenever you talk. So explain to me what that conspiracy was in a nutshell.
Huh. Wow, being on the spot a little. So apparently there was a related group of cultists that were actually using the local orphanage for trying to, further their nefarious ends. And I stumbled upon it while studying my book that I found. And I devised a fiendish plot wherein I cleared everyone out of the orphanage and then in a dark room chuckling to myself, which of course made the sound of children crying because of my corruption, and lured the cultists in, and we were able to put a stop to their plot without any of the children being hurt.
I really like the fact that you worked your corruption into being heroic. That's nice. All right. So what type of living expense, since yours was not prescribed here, were you destitute, poor, getting by, comfortable, wealthy, or rich?
I think I have something like 10 bits to my name. So,
that sounds like poor. So subtract two of those.
Oh.
So you live in squalid conditions. It probably won't affect you much because you're a clockwork. Oh, yeah. Okay, so give me a strength challenge roll. Because at some time in your squalid living conditions, someone attempted to steal something from you.
Oh, good. Really? That does not seem wise. That would be a one.
All right. So you lose one object worth one silver or more. If you have no objects to lose, you become diseased, but you can't. So.
I guess they would have to have taken my original book on magical theory, because if they took my other book or my interesting thing, bad things would probably happen.
You lost your non-cult book on magical theory.
That's unfortunate.
Okay. Next one. Abigail.
Yay.
For your downtime, we will work this back in because I know how this happened, but you got a poor lifestyle automatically. Things went bad for you towards the end of before I move on, I'm assuming you can, which did you have a preference to one of those things for a magician, for what, how you learned your magician craft?
I have this book
that, yeah, I was gonna say
your book screams when I open it,
so. Yeah, your book kind of explains that, but I just wanted to make sure. Okay, so
your book screams when you open it.
Yeah, well, actually a woman voice screams whenever he opens it.
Oh, that's terrific.
And after opening it and reading it, he now has whorls all over his body that occasionally might look like screaming faces, in addition to the children crying when he laughs. And a book that screams when he opens it. Things are going well for Teapot.
That's great.
So Abigail, before things went bad for you, how did you learn your crap?
She went to, when they were traveling, she realized that several places seemed a little bit different than the others. And she decided she would just go out there and figure out what was going on. And, she eventually found herself a fellow priestess of the witchcraft and, spent some time traveling back and forth, probably where she spent all of her money, apparently. And then she went out there and eventually became, I don't know exactly what word I'm looking for, but she's anointed as a priestess of witchcraft at this point.
Okay.
And definitely does not trust the faith of the new god. So.
All right. And you have a pointy hat, because that's canon in the setting. If you're a witch, you have a pointy hat.
I know.
I'm not joking. That is actually canon.
I saw that everywhere I saw a witch. I'm like, really? I don't need additional things to point out that I'm going to get burned at the stake. Really?
Oh, come on. Two of us, I am far more likely for them to attempt to burn.
Yes, but you're metal.
That's why I said attempt.
So for your lifestyle, once again, you are, bad off, so you will have to make a strength challenge or else having lost an item from somebody mugging you, essentially.
Yay.
I'll give you the context here in a moment, but let's just see if you lose anything.
Yeah, right. Uh-huh. Wow, 17.
All right. So Abigail.
Abigail has my book.
At some point, I will find Teapot's book.
And her party mugging. Anyway. So you did well to avoid the problems of being poor, eventually. The context for what happened with your character, you mentioned to me earlier that you had like a noble that was a frequent customer.
Yes.
That traveled through that town when traveling between the city and one of the keeps.
Mm-hmm.
you were going to go visit him and then found out that he had been discredited and anybody that had been associated with him was kind of under scrutiny from the other noble houses because he had apparently performed treason. You don't believe this about him. He seemed like a pretty upright guy. So you think there's some kind of political maneuvering, but whatever happened, he is on the outs and it affected your fortunes for these last few months after you went through your training and showed up in the city.
Makes sense.
Now, the one other thing that happened during this time, someone, a very attractive woman, appears to you at some point when you're at your lowest. She has blue stains on the ends of her fingertips and blue stained lips. And she tells you that she is a member of an order of witchcraft that is trying to right some of the wrongs in the world, that they are far reaching and they have many sisters across the continent. They are looking to do big things and that you would be a perfect addition to their order. And she says, you don't have to make a decision now, but if you would like to fight back against the political oppression and corruption that is striking across the continent, and she gives you the name of this one inn where to ask for a specific person and you will meet a member of her order. So how do you react to this?
Suspiciously.
She's like, you are far too powerful and useful to be in these kinds of conditions. You should never have to end up in a situation like this because of your association with some noble that later proves to be a poor human being. So we want to elevate you, and whenever you make the decision to join us, just meet us at this place. And she gives you I don't know, can Abigail read?
Yes, she can.
All right, that's good, because you can read the note that she gave you.
Yeah, and the fact that I trust my noble and have known him for longer than her, and given that everybody in the last town I was in was slaughtered, this is probably something she's less interested in at the moment. But she will definitely take it into consideration if she really feels that she needs that.
All right. Okay, so now we will move on to Fringe. Brent, for your downtime roll, you find out that one of the items that you own actually has a magical property.
Ooh, okay.
Yeah, Fringe got the good downtime roll.
Excellent. That will work very well into in my level one stuff. I get to pick a profession or a language. And I decided to learn dark speech. So tell me what my tiny glass cage led me to discover, or am I supposed to figure out how that led me to discover?
Magical property is that it just negates, it is completely silent when you want it to be. So if you're holding it, you are silent.
Ooh, okay. That's fantastic. Well, I used my tiny glass cage to silently stalk around in various cults of the city, and that's how I picked up dark speech, as I tried to figure out more of the terrible things that turned me insane last game.
All right, that would make sense. So now, what type of lifestyle would you like to...
Oh, I'm sure she's still, like, on the streets.
All right, so you want to throw in the... let's see, what is it? Comfortable is 2 silver.
Oh, and no, she's not living a comfortable lifestyle.
What's that?
No, not comfortable lifestyle. No, no, no.
Okay.
What's the street urchin one?
Let's see.
Poor or destitute?
Silver.
Probably destitute. Because, like, I envision her frequently forgetting where it is that she lives.
All right. So, destitute, you also have the mugging role, essentially, to hang on to your stuff, except that you have one bane in addition to the...
All right. So what do I roll for my mugging? What's the mugging roll?
You just make a strength challenge roll with one bane.
Oh, nice. Minus one and 1d6.
Ouch.
And I got a 2.
Okay. Oh. So you either lose one object that is worth 1 silver piece or more of your choice, or you can end up being diseased. Which essentially disease just means that you lived in such terrible conditions that you're in bad shape at the beginning of the adventure.
I'll take diseased.
Okay. So for now, until at the end of the first day of this adventure, you can make a strength challenge roll with one bane, and then you will remove the disease condition. Until you do that, you have one bane for everything.
I am immune to damage from disease and diseased, so can I still choose disease?
Why not? Because it seems like, you know, it seems like from a story perspective, clockworks and changelings, you know, it's really hard for them to starve to death on the streets.
I like the idea that she's just a carrier of disease. So she, like, doesn't suffer from it, but, like, she totally got, like, the yellowing teeth and nails and looks like she's got leprosy, but does not actually have leprosy.
If you want to, I will totally let you, you could take a bane on, like, social roles because you look terrible right now until you shake this off.
If I change, do I still suffer the bane if I'm, like, looking like somebody else?
Yeah, I think that would be the neat thing is if, okay, like, every one of your things, like, you could look exactly like someone as if they were sick.
Oh my god, what happened to you, Bob? I saw you 5 minutes ago. I will take that.
So yeah, at the end of the first day, you can shake it off. But for now, like, you're fine, but every person you look like looks like they're sick, and it kind of freaks people out.
Nice.
That is great.
Well, then when Abby sees Fringe, it'll probably be a little bit easier. It's like, oh look, heal you. You need to feel better.
Weird magical fey diseases. Okay. So, Vigdis, your backstory. What came up in your backstory is you got into a fight with someone.
Yes.
Yeah, I know, it's a shock. The person, you didn't die, they didn't die, but you made an enemy of them. So do you have an idea of what kind of person you would have gotten into a fight with?
No. What was the name of that town drunk dwarf from before?
Arno was his name?
From last session.
I wrote this note
down. Fucking guy.
Yes, I actually kept Arno.
Yes.
Arno, yeah. Fucking Arno.
Card handy, just in case.
did the town that we were in, did it get repopulated in the past year, or did we move elsewhere?
No, you're in the city now.
Okay, yeah. So I imagine, like, I just kept running into that asshole. Like, whatever new place he ended up working at, this guy kept showing up. You're like, the only fucking guy from this old town, and I keep seeing you.
You got into a fight with Arno. Arno has sworn eternal enmity with you.
It turns out he's tough as a nickel steak because he was able to handle the ass-kicking that Vigdis was trying to dish out.
Well, yeah, because, yeah, we'll flesh this out now. Arno may have been the town drunk, but at one point in time, he was actually a mercenary, so... So that's good. At some point in the future, Arno will come back. Maybe not in this adventure, but Arno is now a recurring villain for Vigdis.
Love it!
So... Vigdis, what type of lifestyle would you like to have?
Well, he blew all his money on, you know, swords and boards, so I think he's going to have to live poor.
Okay.
For this one, so I'll make my strength check here. Just in my wealth, let's see here. Yeah, 21, so yeah.
So the mugger walks up to Vigdis, and Vigdis...
I'm sort of picturing him like sleeping in an alley, and he's kind of like hunched over, his hands on his knees, and this guy sort of like starts slowly sneaking up towards it, and then you know, Vigdis opens up one eye and just goes,
"Yeah."
The guy's like, "Okay, okay."
Yeah, that I would imagine, given you know just what a Jotun looks like, that probably is all it would take. Guys, I don't think he's dead. Maybe we shouldn't loot the body.
Yeah. Okay.
All right, and finally, Kane. Kane, here was your problem. I think we worked out. Oh yeah, I was gonna say, Vigdis. It doesn't really matter how you got your profession because your profession was you were born a Jotun.
Yeah.
Before I get too far ahead, how did Fringe train for their profession?
I learned my dark speech.
Well, just there's like a little chart there when you take your first path.
On my first path, hold on.
Sorry, I didn't mean profession. I meant, you know, the path.
Well, my initial profession was wilderness tracker. All right, but are you talking about the one that I picked up?
There's a little chart by the path that kind of gives you an idea of what you did to train for that path. You don't have to pick one of those, but if you want something along those lines, as you know, how you learned what you know now for your path.
Let's go with always had a gift for subterfuge, and my training just refined the talents that I had. All
that does make sense, especially if you were using your silent birdcage to track cultists and learn dark speech. All right, so Kane, your unfortunate thing was that you did show up. You had your note that you handed to the local priest. They were using you as a bodyguard for people, and you were getting to guard churches and things like that, because it's a rough and tumble town and there's mercenaries all over the place. So occasionally, you know, I don't know, sometimes you have to protect the poor boxes from mercenaries that would take them. I don't know that when that would ever happen, but
yes, Vigdis.
It's booty.
But unfortunately, towards the end of the year, your fortunes kind of turned around. For whatever reason, the church suddenly didn't have any work for you after you had worked for them for most of the year. And you end up, automatically because of your downtime role, this last month you have been destitute.
Nice.
So give me a strength check with plus one Bane.
So 11, 12.
So Kane does not lose anything. Even though he hasn't had a job for over a month now, when people try and take things from him, they cannot take them from Kane.
That's right.
But you are, you know, since you were searching for this, you know, meaning, and you finally got hired by the church and you felt like this is your calling, because we kind of discussed that a little bit. You're feeling kind of bad that for this last month they just suddenly don't have any work for you at all, and it's kind of wearing on you a little bit here.
That does make me angry. Frustrated, I guess, would be better.
So, now that we have set this up, it has been a year. You all had things happen to you in your past. It's been a great, interesting year for you. Some of you have had highs, some of you had lows. Most of you have had lows because you have no money, and you lived in the crappy city streets away from your nice, comfortable town that you used to live in. But you are currently in the city of Holdfast. Holdfast is... I was going to say it's the largest city in the borderlands of Tyr, but it's actually pretty much the only city in the borderlands. It initially had about 10,000 people living here, but the population has sort of grown because now there is a massive tent city outside the main city, and the tent city has come from refugees that have poured in from the Empire ever since the orcs killed the Emperor and took over. So this has been one of the places where, oh, this place is finally stable, let's go there. And all of the people coming in here and living in the tent city have caused a lot more consternation among people as to what they need to do for things and the lack of resources. The city is, that's, you know, it's actually a good explanation for why so many of you end up kind of living on the street, because there's just not as many resources to go around now ever since things have been going downhill with the Empire. So, now that you are all in the city, strangely, all of you have someone find you that is a runner for the church. Now, what happens when this runner comes up to all of you, they find you all, I'm assuming most of you are separate. If any of you, you know, generally hang out together, you can let me know that, but other than that, the runner will find you no matter where you're at, because they're kind of looking all over the place. But
Abby and Vigdis would probably be the closest too.
That is true.
Yeah. Well, he's happy to tag along with wherever Abby needs to go.
Okay. And I was going to say that the Teapot and Kane both have ties to the church, even though Teapot wasn't doing any official work. And he was learning how to combat evil by delving into the greatest depths of insanity and evil himself.
There was no insanity. Just corruption.
I can fix that now.
A I'm assuming we probably parted ways in the last few months, though, when I was basically fired.
So basically, the runners find all of you where you're at. And you notice the runners, these aren't like you guys, when you got your introductory letter, you got introduced to the regular humble churches that are around here. And those are, you know, much more plain looking, you know, gray and black robes with the very simple circle, you know, images on them. This is, again, somebody that has much more, the runners have much more detailed, richer looking robes when they come up to find all of you. And they all are asking you to meet you back at the original church that Mother Bastion had given you the introductory note for. And the time frame is basically this evening, if you can get there by that point in time. So, would you all like to do that? And do any of you have anything specific you would say to the runner when they show up to you?
I think Vigus would let Abby read it to him and explain what it is.
Does the letter indicate whether the other members of the party are going or have been invited?
It's a general thing from Mother Bastion that says, dear survivors of the town, you did such a wonderful heroic work for me previously. I need your help once again. Please come join me at this location this evening, and we will discuss another way in which you can make the world a much better place. The one true God smiles upon all of you. And that's about it. But it kind of implies that she's addressing this to all of the people that survived the massacre in the town.
So Vigdis kind of scritches his beard as Abby reads that, and as if he's got a, you know, furrowed brow, as if he's really deep in thought. And he said, then finally, after a pause, says, "Does she say anything about pay?"
I think we need to definitely talk about that this time, Vigdis.
So he's happy doing whatever Abby wants to do.
Okay. Does anyone else have any specific things that they want to ask their runners when they bring them this message?
I will read it very, very carefully and look for any hidden meaning, and probably find none and invent one of my own. Are they going to return to Lady Bastion with our reply?
Yes.
Okay, then I will write her something in dark speech.
Okay. Oh, man. Also, since you guys have gotten a level, it's been a year, you've learned more stuff. Anyone with a religion profession could make me a challenge roll for intelligence.
Sadly, I don't have religion.
No, I'm super awesome at slaving.
I'm apparently really, really stuck on this idea of one. So that would be a... 2 with my modifier.
All right. It's okay.
Yeah. All right. I rolled a 2 as well.
All right. So this is going to be one of those clues that we're going to go 11 sessions and nobody picks up on. That's awesome. Anyway, are all of you interested in going to the church and meeting with Mother Bastion?
Teapot will go.
Is this the church? Don't tell me the Radiant Blood.
Yes, it was the original church where you had the introductory letter.
Okay, and do I know that we're going to see Father Stone?
You've already seen him before. He might be there. He might not. She's just asking to meet you there.
Okay, I will make up some terrible rumor about Father Stone, and make that in the note for the dark speech.
Okay.
It's going to be something like really ridiculous. Not necessarily heresy, but like something like, I have it on good authority that Father Stone runs naked through the streets at midnight on Mondays and warbles a devilish song. And just because I want to see if like she gets a reaction from reading the dark speech. Right. Or if she just can't. If it's just unintelligible to her. Although I guess I'm not going to be there to see her read it, but Fringe isn't thinking that far ahead, so.
That sounds like Fringe.
Yeah.
Takes out this letter in my presence and reads it. All right. So, is there anything that any of you would like to do, like in the afternoon, in between getting the letter and going to the church?
Make sure my sword is sharp, the one I stole from the cultists. Hey, Vignus, hold still.
I hold it a whetstone for her.
I don't have enough money to buy better armor, so I'm cool.
Let's Seems see like it. A job would help fix that.
Yeah, well, I was busy.
No, I mean, you know, you might have a job offer here. You're going to make the world a better place. That involves getting paid, right?
It makes my world a better place.
Yeah, we need to definitely talk being paid, because, you know, living poor on the streets kind of sucks.
Teapot's going to head over early.
Okay. So
when the church is not, the meeting place isn't in one of these refugee tent cities, right? It's in the city proper.
No, it's in the city proper, yes.
Yep. You know, I think I'm going to buy myself a small shield.
Nice.
Yeah. I think that's what I'm going to do. So I'll spend 5 copper and pick one up from the marketplace.
Been hanging on to that for a year just so you can get that shield.
By the way, Jared, I need to note that my original dagger that I got with my initial cure is my magical focus.
Ah, yes.
I'm like, wait a minute, I need to say that.
Yes, that is handy. And I'm pretty sure I know what Teapot's focus is.
The book.
Yes.
Yes, the screaming book. You open the book and start casting a spell.
No, if you use that particular item to cast spells from certain traditions, which you can probably guess what type of traditions, you actually do get a boon on them too.
Nice.
your book, I'm picturing like that scene from Bill Murray's Scrooge. Where he's like, he opens it up and the thing's screaming, and he closes it and opens it up again. He's like, "We're gonna get calls."
Yes, you are.
So when Teapot arrives at the church early, you don't see Mother Bastion. You see some petitioners there in church praying, but other than that, there's nothing much going on, unless you want to like poke around, you know, the priest quarters at the back or anything like that.
He's gonna wander around. So, okay. He feels like he needs to know what's going on here.
What's really funny is, like, some of the people that are there praying just kind of, like, look up to see this flying clockwork, and every once in a while catch one of these swirling faces that I'm picturing, since, you know, you're a clockwork, they almost look like engraved faces, except that they move every once in a while.
Oh, dear. Teapot is terrifying.
Stupid transformer face and all the other faces on him now. So yeah, Mother Bastion doesn't show up. There's like a priest and some acolytes here just tending some things, but they're not doing anything in particular.
If it gets really boring, Teapot's going to do a gargoyle impersonation. Inside.
So you perch on like a on one of the upper things and just kind of like sit there with your wings out. Okay, so Teapot is in there. Does anyone else want to do anything before they show up at the church, or should we skip straight to the church?
Church is good.
Okay. What's the limitation on availability for items we can pick up?
This is a town of 10,000 people, and there was at least a lot of trade with the Empire before the orcs overthrew there. So I would say it shouldn't be too hard to find anything as long as you have the coins for it.
I have been holding on to that silver, and I think I want to buy some lockpicks.
Okay.
Because I don't think any of us have lockpicks, and I feel like I should be the one to have them.
My lockpicks? Do you mean giant club?
Yeah, that's what I'm talking about. Exactly. Yes.
Yes, that is not too hard to find at all in this town.
I'll grab one of those then.
All right.
I think that will do it for me, though.
Okay. So you have that. The rest of you kind of show up, and you see each other for the first time in months as you are outside the church, as everyone's kind of showing up at sundown here. And you see the state that each other is in as you're coming in here. For many of you, the year has not been kind to you, and you can kind of see that in one another as you're walking in here. How do you react to one another as none of you have seen Teapot dangling from the upper the upper rafters yet?
I actually do. I just rolled a perception challenge for Vigus to see if he noticed the difference. There's a brief period where he kind of looks at Teapot and the swirling faces on his body and the screaming book and kind of, you know, scritches his beard again and thinks like, yeah, that sounds about right.
Yeah, so Vignes, like, as you guys are walking in the church, immediately, like, looks up and sees the Teapot is perched there.
Oh, dear.
Oh, Teapot flat down and land amongst everybody else.
Abigail, you see that that Fringe looks very, like, disturbing.
Fringe, you might want to get that checked. Would you mind if I helped out with that?
I start to like babble in tongues, and then I just pull out my glass cage and open it, and I turn silent, but the babbling continues, and I just become more fervent babbling at you until I shut the cage very suddenly, and then quietly just put it back in my coat, and then cough once or twice more.
Yeah. So.
Vigus needs to see Kane as well. Because I think as much as Abby is his sort of, he knows to listen to Abby and keep her safe and whatnot, Kane was the first sort of warrior he's met since he's left or, you know, broken company with the Jotun. So he's kind of like, whoa, we're fighting together again.
Looks like I'm not that happy about it. It doesn't look like you guys had a very good time in Holdfast either.
Not so much. Mm-hmm. Abby is going to strongly encourage Fringe to let her tend to his condition.
Her condition, but
her condition.
She seems very distrustful, you know. Okay.
almost like she spent a year following cultists around.
Yeah. Sort of like, you know, when you ever hang out with an abused dog. Dog that has been like hitting stuff by its old master.
Yeah.
Somebody new comes over and like, you know, it's some of that. You're getting some of that.
So Abby is still going to insist and she will hold the handle of her dagger, but not actually pointing it at Fringe, trying to do the focus thing. And we'd like to cast cure. To remove the disease from Fringe. Just to kind of be like, look, I'm a friend. and do I need to roll anything for that? It just says that you can remove the condition.
Unless if Fringe wants to not let you touch her, you would have to make an attack. But if they're just being wary, but Fringe will let you touch her, then you're good.
You did brandish a dagger, so, I mean...
No, I use this to cast spells. Don't worry about it.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's the...
I need this to do my healing magic. Also, you need to close your eyes. Stand still. Go for it. I mean, she's not gonna... You can have a boon on your roll, because she's not gonna try hard. She's not using her shield or anything.
Well, I'll take that, and a boon will give me a 15.
All right, that's definitely more than enough.
All right, so you were never actually diseased, but the weird magical disease that you had that was afflicting all of your appearances has gone away.
All right,
I can't cast spells until I compare that spell again until we rest. But hey, we don't need to be dizzy. You know, we don't need to start out the day horrible.
What's really funny is, though, since this is Fringe's shape-shifted form, normally, like, if you remove somebody's disease, they would still look a little weak or whatever, and the second you cast this, like, they look as healthy as possible. So friend, she's just like immediately like, she looks great. You've never seen a spell remove a disease this effectively before.
What powerful magic you have discovered.
And Abby's going to be like, I'm an initiate. This is okay.
So right, and this is the perfect time for this to happen, right as you finish performing this this rite of witchcraft, Mother Bastion walks in. she's still wearing the same outfit that, you know, the same style of outfit that you saw last year when you met her. She's got the very nice, somewhat different than the regular church, somewhat different than the Inquisition outfit, you know, with the well-tailored robes on as she walks in. And you notice when she walks in and you're completing that, she kind of gives you this, it's a brief disapproving glance, but it is quickly contained as if, you know, like she doesn't want to start something now. It's just sort of, you can register that she wasn't thrilled that you just used a witchcraft ritual in a church of the new god.
Tough cookies.
And as that happens, she walks up to all of you and she goes, "The one true God has shown me once again that you will all be the vessels for his will in this world, and that you all will do a great and mighty thing to banish the darkness in this world. I've had yet another dream of all of you, and that is why I paid out of church funds enough runners to cover the entire city to find all of you. I hope you understand and appreciate the kind of expenditure that I went through, because you are all chosen ones. You are all important, and you will be making a difference."
And given the insanity of the last time you, last time she brought this, Abby's probably going to bust out laughing.
You stopped the cult, and nothing further happened in the town. You halted that evil in its tracks. That is exactly the type of thing that I saw in my dream. And this time, there is a shadow encroaching on someone's soul who should be a paragon of light. I have seen this shadow creeping into his heart, and I have seen you find the shadow and rip it from his body.
I'm still stuck on the town. There's a reason nothing else happened in the town. Everybody's dead, except us.
Yes, and the keeps didn't die, and it didn't spread to Holdfast. You stopped that evil in its tracks. It was very impressive.
And Arno's alive too.
True, but Vigdis doesn't want to think about him.
Yeah, as soon as you mention Arno, Vigdis like swears out loud.
Probably says some unkind things about Arno's mother in Jotun.
And oddly, for Fringe's benefit, she does not pull out the letter and read the letter in front of Fringe.
Yeah.
So, if you would hear my proposal, Bishop Mazin here in town, in the Holdfast, has been at odds with Prince Horus over the direction of the province. We need clear leadership to tell Prince Horus that he needs to march on the capital and reclaim the empire in the name of the new god. And Bishop Mazin, while he has been at odds with the prince, has not wanted to openly act against him. Now, I've been wondering why he would be this reluctant to act. And I have heard, unfortunately, that Bishop Mazin has deep, dark secrets that need to be given to the proper person with leverage to force him to repent. So, given this situation, I need a group of people who have the favor of the new god to enter into a particular property that he owns, and to find any instance of impropriety on his part and bring that instance back to me.
Okay.
How
much are we getting paid?
Well, I can assure you that it will not be less than... I can assure you it will not be less than... And she actually checks her pocket. I will guarantee you 10 silver shillings plus bonuses depending on how important the secrets are that you bring back to me. So at the bare minimum, 10 silver shillings.
Each.
10 silver shillings total. It's very expensive to find all of you. But there will be bonuses if you find really, really important matters that needed to be turned over to a proper person in the church. That I promise that amount will go up. If you find irrefutable proof of something improper, it might go as high as 50 silver shillings.
I will argue that we deserve 25 silver shillings in recognition of our, and I'll be very poignant and elegant as I do so, in recognition of our previous service to the town and church, and furthermore that we deserve to have this advanced to us so that we might acquire items to increase the chances of succeeding on this venture. And I will use my trickery to make a challenge roll with one boon.
All right. Go ahead and make your challenge roll.
What is this, intellect?
Yeah, I think so.
Yeah, I got
to find a reason with her here, sort of.
Challenge roll for money. Oh, and I rolled a 3. So total of 6. Total of 6.
I'm very sorry. We will have to keep the coffers in place in case we need to act against Bishop Mason on any of the issues that are coming up. But I assure you that we will be able to find more shillings for better information that you bring us. Also, make sure that if you find out any of this information, you bring it directly back to me as opposed to any other authorities, because we need to make sure that the right thing is done with this information. It can't just go out broadly to the community. It needs to be funneled to the right corners of the church.
Got it. So it's a political matter in the church.
I wouldn't say it's a political matter. It's a matter of saving Bishop Mason's soul and directing this province in the right direction.
Teapot, having been an Inquisitor henchman in the past, is like, yeah, okay. This sounds pretty normal.
If you should accept this job, I will provide you with disguises and a letter of introduction to go to his guards at one of his estates. You will be funneled down to his private dungeons on this estate, and you will need to not arouse any suspicion and find anything in those dungeons that you possibly can. The bishop may show up at any time, so you will need to act very quickly. The guards should let you in without any trouble, but try to not arouse their suspicion.
Okay, hold on, time out. When you say disguises, Teapot will look at himself and look at the Jotun and look back.
Oh, no, the letter of introduction.
Into dungeons. You're not sending us in as prisoners.
No. That would be ridiculous. Now, of course, those of you that do not look like that you would be normal members of the church, I will have an introduction that will explain that you are the servants of the other members that are showing up.
Which would work for Vigdis.
Teapot will lean forward and say, I've been a member of this church longer than you've been alive.
And we appreciate your service. As like as you fix her with that stare, like some of the faces on the sides of your thing start like sneering at her unconsciously. And she kind of like turns away from you for a moment. And she's like, it is all right. The letter will clearly mention that you are a duly appointed henchman of the Inquisition. But yes, she will have official Inquisitor's robes for Fringe, Abigail, and Kane.
So we're now effectively the Church of the New God, Spanish Inquisition. Got it.
No one will expect us.
Except you can't get caught, because that would still look bad. Because somehow, despite the fact that she's assuring you that this is completely normal church business, she doesn't want the bishop finding out before you have dirt on him.
Yeah, this is political. This is, she doesn't like what he's doing.
FYI, after, like, as I'm about to lose sight of her and we eventually leave, I will be using Steel Identity to make myself look like Mother Bastion.
That is
oh,
great.
Oh, dear.
That's great. The other thing that she points out is the best time to do this would be fairly early in the morning, right after the bishop has left the estate. So you will have tonight to make your plans, rest up, and get ready for this.
Oh, well, this is not going to go well.
Don't know why you're that worried about it.
I didn't know that.
It could go. I think if Mother Bastion's right and there's something in here, great. But frankly, I don't. Once she's gone, of course, I don't trust this at all. it doesn't. Okay, the guys up there at the highest levels of with the prince, and why in the world would the church want us to move? Or why in the world? Well, okay, they want to set up a theocracy and burn people like me at the stake. That's beside the point. Why in the world would the church want to go to war with the empire as a whole that just got overthrown by orcs? Create the theocracy, create essentially the same kind of, we'll just say indentured servitude for the orcs as they used to have, but why?
What's interesting is, from what you know of the Church of the New God, is depending on the region, the Inquisition is very zealous about ferreting out devil worshippers and strange cultists of the void. In general, it is now church practice that followers of the old gods are not necessarily bad. They may be wrong, but you should work with them. So relations with them have gotten much better in recent years, but there are some pockets of the church that are still very much big on converting everyone, and occasionally the Inquisition accidentally still, burns a priest of witchcraft as if they were a cultist, because sometimes it's hard to tell. And they do still use the term witch hunter, which implies something beyond
a little bit.
Yeah.
Yeah, that sounds about why I should not trust them at all. So it just makes me really leery, because as she's describing that the prince won't go along with attacking the empire, I think he's being prudent by not attacking, because if you throw an entire region at war, even a holy war of some sort, there are priests of the new god over on the other side in the empire too.
This is, from what you've been able to hear, especially since you're in the city, this is one of the most stable places in the empire right now, compared to, closer to the capital, where things went completely into chaos when the orcs installed their king.
So very nonchalant. Why would we give up our stability?
Fringe will say very nonchalantly that there are probably agents within the church that seek to weaken the light of the world so that the shadows of the demon lord can embrace us all.
And like most of you have never heard these terms before, Teapot, you're a little nervous that
the fringe
is that clear on
the very animal. very lucid, just like straight-faced.
Oh, no, it's not that part of it that's disturbing the Teapot. It's the other part that's disturbing the Teapot.
Well, yeah, because basically most people in reality, they know, they nebulously know that the void is this bad thing outside of reality. So cultists associated with that are bad. But they don't really know literally that there is a demon lord trying to erase multiple realities from existence. But given that Fringe has been following cultists around for the last year, Fringe knows way too much about exactly what's really going on in the world.
Instead of demon lord, let's say that she uses his name in the dark speech.
So Teapot.
Oh dear.
Also in dark speech, it's nice that you know the true tongue. That name.
Another speaker. She seems happy about it.
Oh man. Yeah, there's not any paranoia going on there. Yeah. So poor Kane, you're just hearing them both say these things, and like the language literally sounds like deep guttural growling while scratching fingernails on chalkboards, and they're talking back and forth in this language.
They've been pretty weird all along, so let's do our best to do what we need to do and let them do their weird stuff on their own.
It's nothing to worry about.
not too much I can do about it, really.
So everyone, if you don't have anything else to do, you get a good night's rest before you're ready to do this clandestine mission into the Bishop's Dungeons tomorrow. Is there anything you want to do before you turn in for the evening?
What's the letter? Do we already have the letter?
Yeah. The letter basically just says that you are inquisitors from... You originally came from the Holy Kingdom. You have the seal of the Inquisition itself. You need to just do a routine consensus of some of the items that are located. You're not going to take anything specific. You just need to do just a routine check of local church facilities. And it's signed by one of the... one of the bishops from the Holy Kingdom directly, which would have authority over Bishop Mazin. You wonder if that signature is accurate or not. I mean, you don't know, but it's a pretty high up signature from the church to have just, lying around.
Why would that lead directly into the dungeon?
What's that?
Because she said that would lead us directly in the dungeon or something, that they would
When you go to the estate and present this to the guards, they will take you to the dungeon so that you can therefore go and
That's where the items are, presumably, then?
Yes.
All right. Well, I guess we must do what we must do.
Good grief.
So Fringe, basically, you're stuck looking like Mother Bastion until you can see Mother Bastion again. Unless you want to switch to somebody else.
Right. I'll be keeping that, yeah.
So what's funny about this is everyone, Fringe looks like Mother Bastion as Fringe has been having all of these conversations.
It's almost like I sent a messenger with the dark speech letter to her, and now I'm going to walk around talking around dark speech with her and building her reputation for speaking in the dark tongue.
Hey, our tier two adventure will be looking into these weird rumors that Mother Bastion is some sort of cultist.
I don't know where these rumors start, but...
Right? So weird.
Oh, man. So, you have Mother Bastion with you, and I'm going to assume that Abigail puts on the robes provided for her, and so does Kane?
Yes.
Yes. But I'm keeping my hat in my bag.
Okay. Yeah, because you have to have the hat with you.
I'm pretty sure you can't. I think that's just kind of grafted on. You grow
No, there's a couple pictures in the book of them holding the hats. It's not grafted on yet.
Just staple it to your head.
You can't cast unless you're wearing it.
you grow it.
Technically you could make the hat your implement, couldn't you?
I could, but then I'd get flashbacks to the D&D cartoon, Magic Do What You Will.
Yeah. Okay, so you arrive at the estate. You're at the gate of the estate, and there's some guards standing there. And these appear to be some well-appointed guards. They have nice swords. They have large shields. They're wearing mail armor. They have the really nice tabards on. And they both stand on either side of the entrance, and they look at you and go, "Inquisitors, what is your business here?"
Mother Bastion, I believe you need to present the letter.
I will not present the letter very regally.
And they look it over. We were not informed that there was going to be an official audit coming anytime soon, or else we would have had the estate in better repair. Is there a particular reason for this audit at this time?
Teapot will hop up on his shoulder, lean in close, and go, "Do you really need to know?"
Teapot, give me a social attack.
I will lean in towards Teapot and whisper something in dark speech, just loud enough that they can hear. It's weird.
No, that's a bad idea.
A boon and a bane cancel out, right?
Yes.
Yes.
Ooh, I've graduated to a 5, so 6.
Oh, so the guards hear the dark speech and they see the writhing faces on the clockwork, and they look at the letter and they go, "Right this way." And they escort you inside the gates, and they open up the doors that lead downstairs into the dungeon. Head right in if you would like.
I don't like the smirk on the GM's face when he says that.
I don't know why you're saying that.
I don't trust the guards, of course. So are they acting in any way that you would be considered strange?
Like us?
Stranger than us?
Give me a perception challenge roll.
With or without a bane, because I'm not familiar with the church.
No, I mean, this is just kind of reading human reactions, so...
I can do that, given my profession.
yeah. Actually, you know what? I will let you add a boon for your profession.
All right. Well, that doesn't help me a whole lot because it's only 1, but hey, it's something better than nothing. 19.
Yeah. You get the feeling that these guards are not entirely sold on this story, and they're just kind of trying to placate you so this doesn't escalate without them having a better advantage here.
All right. So, you'll have to forgive our mechanical servant here. However, we are on official church business. Is there a second entrance to the dungeon, perhaps?
Well, not really, but is there a particular reason you don't like this entrance?
Well, you're awfully defensive, and it'd be a shame to have to recommend that you be replaced. I'd hate to have anybody lose their jobs over not escorting members of the Inquisition to the correct entrance.
Give me another social attack roll. And if anyone else would like to undermine this by doing something weird.
Oh! 22.
All right, so you are so calming to them, and you know, you have such an air of authority that even though you're kind of threatening them, they trust that that's the type of threat that comes from an inquisitor, not the type of threat that comes from somebody that's just wearing robes that look like an inquisitor's robe. So they look at you and they go, "We will be entirely honest with you. We're not entirely comfortable with this audit going on without the bishop's knowledge. So we'll leave the doors here. We will keep them propped open. But we are going to send a runner to go speak with the bishop because clearly there's nothing that says the bishop can't be present for the audit. You can start your audit whenever you'd like, but the bishop will be on his way within an hour or so as soon as he is free from other engagements."
Duly noted, and as it should be. So,
so this now gives you about an hour's worth of time to toss this thing for useful information.
Well, it's better to actually know our time limit than not. So they send the runner, and I am golden with that.
So do you walk down these stairs into the dungeons?
I think so. Dark?
Yes, and pull out a torch.
It is actually not dark. The interesting thing that you note as you walk down here, in the setting, the richer places, like in the capitals and the larger cities, there is actually more of like a steampunk level of technology as opposed to in the outer areas and the, you know, the provinces and such. So you notice there's actually like stationed alchemical lamps all over this place that are just like ever burning here. So it's actually a well-lit corridor that you walk into. And as you walk down here, you see one area straight ahead that looks like it has a desk and a bunch of books and scrolls and everything. And then there's three different alcoves that seem like they lead down into various hallways. And then there's the stairs that lead back up. This area kind of looks like a relatively well-appointed area. There's a nice rug on the ground. Calling this a dungeon, I mean, this looks like an office area in this particular region.
Yeah. What about secret doors? That's the first thing I think of, is if they're trying to hide something, that's what we need to be finding.
Okay, give me a perception test.
Dang. All right. I 19.
So as you're looking around the room for like seams or anything that would indicate a secret door, you don't find anything like that. But you notice that there are these strange like copper wires that seem to be embedded in the handles of various doors that lead down into the floor. And then there's more of that. And there's kind of like a copper inlay on the floor, like underneath the rug and all around the corners, and it almost looks more like an artistic design, but now that you see it, you see that there's like these wires that lead from all of the door handles into this floor.
Underneath the rug?
Yes, underneath the rug and all around, like there's just like this, it looks like these artistic flourishes, but now that you see, it's like pretty much anywhere you step, you're going to be near this copper inlaid metal work here, and it's just like these filigrees and these flourishes and all over the place, but now that you can notice they're all connected and they all run back to the wires that go up into the doors.
Teapot is going to fly over and sit on the desk, or stand on the desk, because there's no wires there while we figure this out.
So the bishop's office, the door to his office is actually open, but it has the same mechanism as all of the closed doors that are down the hallways, that lead to the hallways.
The door's open so we can just walk in?
Yes.
I'll walk in there and see what's going on. See if he's got anything in there.
In his office, there are several bookshelves. There are some scrolls that are laying on a few surfaces. He's got his ink and his quill that are sitting there on his desk. He's got the lamps in here are, you notice that there's like a little knob that you can turn that turns up or down the alchemical fluid that is causing the lights to go on or off in here. And it's turned down a little bit, but the office looks rather nice, but it looks like he was working on things. There's like ledgers laying out on the table and everything.
Well, I don't think he's going to have anything just sitting out we want to see, but there must be some way to get down to where the wires are going below the floor.
Yeah, so. We need to... Can we roll up the rug and see what if they connect to something centrally?
If you roll up the rug, you're just seeing like there's just this pattern. Like there's just this copper pattern that all the wires run into.
Scholastic knowledge of either theory of magic or occult, which I have both of.
Sure, give me a theory of magic. Since that's a background, give me a boon on that.
Oh, okay then. 21 total. Excuse me, plus my int, so 22 total.
You would guess, looking at this, that this is probably some kind of arcane trap used to funnel electricity if someone does the wrong thing.
I will explain that.
Yeah, now we need to figure out what causes the trap to go off. And I would guess the fact that one door is open, that it's a closing. Okay, this is metagaming too much, but you're closing the circuit by closing the door. There's one door open.
If that's where you want to proceed on, that's fine.
I think that it's actually, if anything, I mean, we have a door open. I'm willing to bet unpleasant things will happen to you if you open other doors while that door is open, because that ensures that people who come barging in aren't going to barge into other things without a unpleasant surprise. I mean, that's what I would do.
Can you just cut the wire leading to the handle and then open the door? Then it would no longer be connected, right?
Yes. Would someone that has thieves' tools like to attempt that? Because that might give them a boon.
I will attempt that with my thieves' tools. And that is an agility roll. Oh, no, you know what? I put my thieves' tools. Lock picks is what I have. Intellect challenge roll. And I have a +1 intellect.
All right.
Oh, sweet. This is the same roll that I made for the money, so I'm sure it's going to go much better. It does. I got a 15.
All right. So you walk at which one of the... There's three different alcoves that have doors in them. Which one would you like to attempt to disconnect?
Third one.
Okay. So you look at the wire. You see that there appears to be... when you go to disconnect this wire, when the door is open... even a little bit, there appears to be a little metal tab on the bottom of the door that there's a break, and then it touches the pattern. And so if you open the door even a little bit, it touches that pattern, but you have disconnected the wire that leads from the door handle down to that.
Okay, I give a thumbs up.
We'll open it. See what's in there.
So you touch the door handle now?
I gave a thumbs up. I did not say I opened it. Someone else said they opened it.
No, I said open
it. Fine, we'll make the Jotun open it.
No, he's not here. I'll do it.
Good use of the guy that isn't here.
Exactly.
He said use him as a meat shield.
He's got a hunch down to fit in this alcove because it's only about like 8 feet tall, so that's actually taller than him. So he kind of hunches down on his shoulders and reaches over for the door. And he kind of looks at you for a minute. It's like, Abby, you can't open your own doors, and because he's not quite getting the, you know, the whole sequence that everyone's going through, worrying about opening these doors.
It's manners. It's manners. That's all we're trying to do is teach you manners. You open doors for ladies.
And he goes and he touches the door handle and he goes to pull it and it doesn't open. And he goes, it's locked. Do you want me to unlock it? And he starts like, you know, reaching for his club.
I don't think we need to worry about that, Fringe.
I will attempt to unlock the door.
Okay. Give me another challenge roll.
I got exactly 10.
Nice. That is exactly what you needed.
Success.
So the doorway, number 3. Oh, also, just to let you know, because I have my cues that tell me how much time to add when, all of that took about 10 minutes of your time so far. Getting through the doorway. So... you have, roughly, depending on how quickly they summon the bishop, you have about 50 more minutes.
50 minutes.
So, when you open the door, you see a long hallway. You see cages on either side of the hallway. The roof here, it widens out to about 10 feet, so it's a little easier for Vigdis to duck in and come back in. At first you might wonder why you would need the hallway to get that much higher, except that in the middle of the hallway, you see this intimidating thing. It is a metal creature that is made out of like brass, and it has it is very artistically. It has like black lacquer on it in various places. It has like metal symbols of the new god that are like really rendered. It's like the serpent biting its own tail in multiple places on its body, and it's vaguely humanoid. It's generally humanoid shaped, but the face does not have any features other than two glowing eyes. But it's a really well-made, artistic-looking construct. But each of its hands, it's about 9 feet tall, and each of its hands end in a battle axe.
Hello, Thomas.
And it is standing about halfway through this thing. And, Fringe, since you open the door, give me a perception check.
Do I have terrible perception? No, I don't. I have good perception. And I have shadow sight. I'm sorry.
Yes.
I got a plus one. So watch out, guys. A 10.
So you see in the cage at the far end, it's a little obscured by the construct, but you see a disheveled but very attractive what appears to be a young woman, but she has very sharp features and maybe pointed ears. And she looks like she has been brutalized in some way, like has been slapped around, beaten. And she is inside this cage, and she seems to be like intentionally not touching the sides of this cage.
Okay. I will whisper that there is some bitchy looking elf inside of an electrified cage inside, and that she appears to have been abused. Ready your crossbow.
And you also notice, like, as the construct has not really reacted. You open the door and it doesn't seem to do anything.
But everybody else can see the construct, right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's very easy to see the construct. It's huge.
Is it a construct or is there clockwork?
I'm going to say you know this well enough. You look at it, it does not have an animating spirit in it. It has a magical program, essentially. So it is a construct, not a clockwork.
Well, it's not fully sentient.
Do you want to check the other doors so we know what we're choosing? Or do you want to try and... I mean, is there a reason we want to go and talk to this elf chick? Because this doesn't really seem like it proves anything, right?
Well, what's the relationship with the church and elves?
In general, the church doesn't have an official stance on elves. Elves are not particularly religious in this setting. Fae are things that you tend to avoid if you're a civilized being because they don't see the world like other people, and they might play really creepy games with you, or they might play really fun games with you, but then take 20 years out of your life that you don't realize. So in general, there's not a specific church stance on elves. It's just that they are, by and large, not pious beings that respect any deity.
The bishop appears to have a impious playmate.
Would, but I mean, Fae tend to want to be free out in the wilderness, essentially, right?
Mm-hmm.
So holding one here is a form of torture.
I'm pretty sure the beating would also be a form of torture.
Well, that too, and putting them in an electrified cage most likely is torture. I mean, unless you're really into that sort of thing, but that's a little bit extreme for my tastes. Holding something of that nature against its will just seems wrong, especially in the city. I mean, why would there be any reason to have hold a fae in the city?
Maybe she's part of a cult or something. I mean, I don't.
It is possible. Corrupt fae.
or he has a fey playmate, which I'm not sure if that's frowned upon or not, but...
Oh, also, I'll throw this out here because Fringe probably would pick up on this. Fringe, you don't get the feeling that she's not touching the bars because they're electrified. You're getting the feeling that the bars are iron.
Oh.
Which you also wouldn't want to touch.
So I will say, I'll amend my statement and say that she's in a cold iron cage.
That's...
Well, does this have anything to do with us? I mean, is this the evidence we're looking for?
Not yet, I don't think.
No, it may prove that he's got certain tastes, but I don't think that it proves beyond a shadow of a doubt that he's corrupt.
Unless she has information, that's why I say let's check something else first that seems more obvious.
Yeah.
Quicker.
I'm with you.
Okay.
Would you like to start working on the next door?
Sure.
Which, the alcove number one or two, since you went to three?
Number one.
All right.
I got 12 on my lockpick roll to look for traps and disable them.
Yeah. It's got the same setup as every other door, so if you open it more than a few inches, it will make that contact. So I will say for each door you practice this on, you're getting an extra boon. So, like, this one you'll have one extra boon for. The next one you'll have two total boons because you're getting really good at knowing how to cut that wire.
All right, then I got a 14.
All right. So you cut the wire. Do you attempt to open the door?
Yeah.
Okay. It is also locked.
I failed to open that door. I got a 5.
Okay. There's no consequence except that it's going to take more time to attempt to unlock it again. Would you like to?
Yeah. It's a minute to lockpick.
Okay.
One question.
23 on number two, so I kill it.
One question while Fringe is working on the locks. Mm-hmm. Is there any sort of log near the doors or near the alcoves?
Not out by the doors, no.
Okay.
There weren't any other people in any of those cages either, right?
No, there were other cages, but none of them had anyone in them other than the one at the far end of the hall. Okay. All right. So with cutting the wire and that extra minute that you needed there, you're up to 21 minutes so far down here.
You want to start working on door number three, or I guess number two, while we look inside this one?
Yeah, sure.
Okay. So you will have... I will give you two boons on both the lock and the trap for that one, since you're dealing with similar things here and they're all identical.
I kill it on the trap for the 26 and a 21 on the lock.
Okay. So you'll be doing this while they're exploring that. I'm adding it onto the time, but it's not. This is concurrent. So while you're doing that, they're in here. Hallway number one, you see a coffer sitting in basically the other one opened into this really long hallway. This one just kind of opens up into a room, and in the room there is just this locked chest. Well, there is a chest with a lock on it. Let me put it that way.
Anything specific about the chest? Any sort of runes or anything on it?
This one, no.
Probably has coin in it. If I were either that or skulls of the victims.
I'm gonna use my magician thing, which I'm currently trying to locate again. Sorry, I don't know if it's detect magic or sense magic. That's what I'm looking for.
Okay.
I'm gonna go over near the chest and a sphere 5-foot radius oriented on me.
Okay. This particular chest does not
ongoing magical effects in the area.
The only magical effect in the area leads to all of those wires that are leading off of all the things which are not currently activated, but the chest itself does not have anything.
Is the chest connected to any of the wires?
No. It's just running through all the patterns on the floor.
Well, that was a much less useful use of a zero level spell than I would have liked.
No, but now you know that if anything triggers one of those things, that entire floor is connected.
Yeah. That would be bad. It's not magical. Any contents are not magical. I can't do locks.
Vigdis offers to open locks.
How big is it?
It's about that big. Not a huge chest, but, you know, probably a medium-sized one.
Well, let's do it more quietly, Vigdis. I think we can take this chest out of this room and have Fringe open it while we open the next door. And Vigdis is certainly big enough to carry pretty much anything that's in that chest.
So yeah, he picks it up. You notice it definitely jingles when it's picked up. So it does sound like there's something metallic inside of it. So Vigdis will carry that out and set it on the floor outside. And you guys would like to go check out the next door?
Yep. Door number 3, Monty.
All right. So when you open the door, you see there's another closet that looks like that one. There is another chest. However, this chest looks different. It is much more ornamental. It has various symbols of the Church of the New God engraved on the surface of it.
I guess I'll make my second use of a zero-level spell.
Okay. So when you do this, not only do you have the enchantment running through the floor through all of the copper plating, but you also feel that they're all of the runes on the or all the symbols on the chest have an enchantment, and there's something inside the chest that is also supernatural in nature.
Okay.
I'm thinking that's so probably what we're looking for, but
the runes are magic, and there's something magic inside.
Doesn't seem that untoward to me.
Nothing outside of the elf really has seemed all that out of place to me. I mean, sure, he's got a chest of probably coin here, which Fringe is probably desperately trying to unlock, if I were guessing.
Yeah, is Fringe unlocking that while they're exploring this?
Of course. I'm going to unlock it while their attention is occupied elsewhere.
All right. What is your challenge roll for that?
All right, hold on. I only get the one boon for this for my, tools. First chest. Oh, I got a 9.
So from out in the hallway, you guys hear Fringe like lightly cursing, possibly in dark speech.
Oh, of course,
in dark speech.
So you hear this cursing in dark speech for some reason out in the hallway.
What do the would be magical theory to see what the runes are for?
Okay, give me a challenge roll.
That would be a 14, 15.
These are protective seals. If you attempt to handle this box and you do not know the proper prayer to say over them, they will go off. It is possible, however, to disarm them by touching the box in the right places. You could attempt to magically disarm it with your knowledge of the arcane.
That sounds like a great plan.
Can I do something while he's doing that?
Sure.
I'm going to actually go in there and check all the ledgers in the office. Maybe the elf is on one of the ledgers as a prisoner or something, or what's going on.
All right. Give me an intelligence challenge. Well, let me see. Did I have that as? Actually, I think. Yeah, just give me a perception challenge in the office to see if you notice something that looks worthwhile.
12.
Okay. So, yes, I made a list of what you could randomly find. The first thing that you notice that's kind of like under some papers that it appears important, but not overly incriminating, you find a ledger that mentions that the amount of the bishop's personal stipend is in the closet, and it explains exactly how much is in there, which might be handy in case someone else opens it and tells you there's a different amount. But according to the ledger, there is supposed to be 50 silver shillings in the coffer for his, and this is his, just to give you an idea, besides the operational expenses of the church, his personal stipend is 50 silver shillings. Compare that to what you guys have made.
Yeah. Madam Crazy Lady owes us a lot more money.
So that's the first thing. You can spend another 10 minutes looking for useful things.
Am I caught up to everyone? Or
yeah, everyone right now, we're at 31 minutes.
I guess use a combination of magic theory, occult theory, and my knowledge of the church, along with my book, to try to figure out the proper places to touch the box.
Okay, so what I'm
Abby's gonna go join Kane with the ledger searching.
Yeah, I have two people searching while he does that, and I guess leave Bigdis to help in case something crazy happens.
You hear a woman scream from the middle one?
Yeah, you hear this young woman scream as the book opens up.
Bigdis is unfazed.
Anyone that notices this, that like he actually dips this key in blood and turns it in the lock to open it.
Huh. Where'd he get the blood?
The blood and the key, not, you know, out of character. It was actually in the same bundle with the book when you guys found the book.
And it's not hard to replace blood.
Yeah. You actually don't want that blood to go away because it might be harder to replace it. But, so anyway, you do this. I will give you two boons because one, you're using the book, and the other, you're using one of your magical knowledges to do that. For those of you, for each additional person that's in the office helping to toss it, next 10 minutes, add a boon. So whoever wants to make the lead roll, the other person adds a boon to it.
That would be a 23 between my int and all of that.
Nice. So, you're like touching this in all the right places, and you basically short out the connection between all of the holy symbols on the outside of it, and they all flare for a second, and then go dark. And you have the feeling now that you could probably handle this thing without radiant damage blasting you.
I'll open it.
And between the people in the office looking for more stuff and you disarming this, we're now up to 41 minutes. Also, as you're getting ready to open it, those of you in the office, who's making the lead role for the looking for more stuff in the office?
Do you have a bonus, Steve?
I do not.
I have a plus one with perception, so.
Okay. I have, perception is intellect-based.
Yeah.
I have a plus two.
Well, then you do have a bonus, so you should roll.
All right, I rolled and
Kane is giving the boon to Abigail.
Mm-hmm. And then rolling the boon. Yeah, I rolled really well.
All right.
26.
All right.
Natural 20. I'm liking my Game Master dice. I bought these to run games with my poor players.
All right. So the next thing that you find, unfortunately, it jumps out at you. Most of the stuff you're finding, it's either like this person's getting transferred to this church, or these people are registering for this, or these ceremonies were done. There's relatively simple stuff just saying we paid out this amount for this stuff. But like every once in a while, something will jump out at you as this is important. And this one jumped out as you have a list of what looks like a list of people working for the bishop that have committed various crimes, who the bishop has had to pay off for those things, and, you know, all of the different secrets associated with that.
All right, so he's hiring criminals.
Well, it's not so much that he's hiring criminals. He's covering up, like, you know, so-and-so got tired of their mistress and had her murdered and dumped in the river, but unfortunately the watch discovered it, so we had to pay this watch commander this amount to... So it's a list of that sort of thing.
So it's a list of people to either that have blackmail material on him or his people of his employ.
Yeah.
All right.
So this definitely counts as something, you know, juicy for corruption-wise to turn in, but it does not directly relate to the elf.
How long do we have before?
You are currently at 41 minutes.
Let's go after the elf. What the hell? Let's beat up this thing and grab the elf and see what she knows.
And while that's going on, Fringe, you have... To stay caught up with everyone else, you could make 9 more attempts to open that chest.
I got it on my second attempt, so I have 8 minutes to figure out what's inside and what I can safely take. I think I can get away with taking, because obviously you're going to expect to find something in this chest.
Yes, other than, you know, the fact that Kane has the thing saying exactly...
I do not know that. I don't think he publicly announced... Or if he did, then I have 8 minutes to take stuff out and put some more stuff back in.
Yes, but yes, you open it up and you see 50 silver shillings in there.
Yeah, is there anything else?
That is it. Well, there's a note basically saying that here is the monthly stipend, blah, 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 blah. This is collected from all these different areas. All the nice above board accounting stuff that happens for them collecting this and having it delivered to him.
Oh, shit, and I don't have any ink. okay, well, I
awarded you this month. Please disregard the other notes.
Crumple up that parchment and shove it in my pants, and then I will take...
Put it in my pants.
You know what? I'm just going to roll it. I don't want to sit here and deliberate for 20 minutes. I will take 9 silver from that.
Okay.
That's his pay.
I don't know. This is just what was in there.
Okay, so you guys are all together again. And also remember, not you know, being the nice GM that I am, your letter did explicitly say you weren't taking anything out. You were just auditing.
Yes, I have Vigdis put the chest back in the room that we unlocked. It's like, okay, it's just got coin in it. And yeah.
You mean it just has nothing in it? But anyway.
Oh. Yeah, well, we got to be somewhat on the up and up here. So it's the elf at this point. We need to figure out what's going on with the elf and then get out of here.
I open the magic box.
Okay. When you open the magic box, we'll cut back to that, and then everyone will be back together again. You open the magic box, you see there are 12 jars in the box. And do you lift one of the jars up and look at it?
Yes, I do.
When you lift the jar up, there appears to be a very interesting wax seal across the top of the jar. Etched on the inside of the jar appears to be some sigils of different stuff, you know, various, you know, magical traditions in there. Not necessarily divine traditions. You can tell that just glancing at it. This is just general magic, you know, more arcane than it is divine. And inside you see this swirling, vaguely glowing, green mist. And every once in a while that mist forms into what almost looks like a face.
Okay. As somebody who, well, has the necromantic tradition and in fact has Harvest Soul,
Yeah, these are jars of souls.
Huh.
There's our evidence.
Right. I will gingerly place the source of hit points back into the jar, and close the lid and carry it out.
So yeah, you have the box contains 12-bound souls.
So we have 12-bound souls, and this is pretty impressive. I mean, low-level magic can, you know, keep a soul for maybe 4 hours. These appear to be bound by the magic in the jars for significantly longer.
Yeah, they're sealed for freshness.
As an interesting note, any of the people whose souls are currently in these jars cannot be resurrected by any means while their souls are here.
Do we have any indication of who these people are?
Not in anything that you've found so far. So now that we're all caught up and everyone's kind of back together again, we are at 41 minutes. What would you like to do?
Question for people who are members of the church. Given Teapot's description of what this is, how damning is this evidence in, as far as the church is concerned?
Well, necromancy tends to be considered a dark art by people who have various views of the world, including that of the church.
Yeah, and anybody that's worked with the church for any amount of time would know that just in general, anything that keeps the natural flow of souls is that when a person dies, they go into the underworld if they do not have any corruption. They forget their past life, but they retain any moral strengths that they have gained, and then they are reborn. So they just keep becoming a better and better person, but they don't necessarily remember their last life. If they die and have any corruption on their soul, they go to hell and the devil speed on their corruption until there's nothing left of them, and then what's left of their soul comes back, but it doesn't have any of the strength of their past life.
And so sometimes that actually works.
Keeping souls bound is definitely against the natural order of things.
And in his explanation of this, Teapot did in fact add the "and sometimes that actually works."
Not that, you know, anyone would pick up on.
I did catch that, Ryan. So really, how big are these jars? And would they fry in sunlight?
About one soul size.
That's a super size soul.
Are we talking a mason jar size? Are we talking a giant pickle jar size? Are we talking a vial size?
Yeah, it's like mason jar sized.
All right. Physical evidence of necromancy would probably do everything we need it to do as far as the Inquisition is concerned. But if we are caught with the jar, then we're kind of hosed. But if he knows that somebody is coming for him, he's going to hide them.
No, we got these from the bishop.
Yeah, that's going to be a logical thing, but we need to get them out. We need to get at least one of these jars out of here.
See, if I had more money, I would have a secret compartment at this point, and we could just put them in that. But no.
At this point, you know, I still have my bag. We could throw it in my bag, but if we're searched, we're screwed.
Yes. It's not quite like if you carried a whole chest of things out. You can probably stuff a jar into something and hopefully, if you don't arouse suspicion.
This is easy. Pull a dagger, etch some dark speech into the chest, desecrating runes and stuff of the church. In our audit, we found this clear abomination sitting down here. We're confiscating it. Done.
All right. And if you attempt to take that out, then we will do the social attack roll and see how that plays. That is definitely a way to go.
Okay, that actually sounds like a logical plan. But
I'm surprised.
It's dark, but yes, it makes sense. And source of hit points, I'm just mildly worried about Teapot and what he drinks.
Well, that wasn't a verbal thing. Just throw that up there.
That was just the gear spinning really loud inside of his head.
Yeah, because he wouldn't say, as someone who practices necromancy.
But yes, so yeah, you're still, I mean, all this discussion, you're still at 41 minutes here. Would you like to do anything else before you attempt to leave?
We could just say that the elf is held up by, you know, against her will, obviously, when we report.
Yes.
Should we leave someone here, like, keep an eye on what's going on? Just to see what the, you know, just like watching the place or something? Because obviously the bishop is going to see that his chest was taken and be pissed about it and take off or whatever. So it seems like we should keep someone like watching the place to see where he goes or something, right? Or no? See if he takes the elf out or.
That would be a good task for Fringe, actually.
Sounds like it, but I was hoping she'd volunteer.
If only we knew someone. Someone who was really sneaky and good at following cultists for a year.
Fringe? Well,
what exactly is it that you want Fringe to do, and how are you posing the request?
We need you to not be seen and just make sure if the bishop leaves, we know where the bishop goes.
Okay, and where am I supposed to case him out from?
Well, that we are in a city, so a nearby building?
Yeah, right. there's some alleyways where you can see the front gate to this estate from.
Well, wouldn't we need to also cover the back gate?
This particular estate, it just opens up on one street. Because it's actually the back side of it is actually up against one of the city walls.
Well, I mean, well, she like just kind of like
on a wall.
Looks around at this dungeon and sort of like at the person carrying the souls in the jars and be like, you don't think that maybe he has more than one way to get out of this place?
I'm hoping he hasn't read the evil overlord list, okay?
Maybe he doesn't think of himself as an evil overlord.
I'm not saying I'm unwilling to do this. I'm just pointing out that, like, you know, this looks like some sneaky business. If I were a person of great means and status and I had a castle and a dungeon and I was doing necromancy, I would probably have an escape route that people were unaware of or could not easily see.
Or and it might behoove us.
Oh, well, you know.
It is, but at the same time, if he flees, then he's obviously showing how guilty he really is anyway. I was just kind of just in case he was trying to like sneak out the elf or do some stuff that would stop the actual Inquisition from showing up here and putting him under guard, you know, just, I mean, don't get yourself killed or anything. You just do the best you can and we'll go from there.
Well, that's what I'm saying. Like, I don't think that he will. I don't see the value in watching his front door. I'm sure there are people already watching his front door.
Well, you can find the back door if you want.
That's what I'm saying. Look for the back door before we leave this place. Maybe sabotage it, and then it would be useful for somebody to watch the front door.
Well, the only exit we've seen other than in the dungeon is the one that goes through that automaton, so...
Well, we haven't checked either of the alcoves for secret doors. I'm not very good at that.
Well, let's look for secret doors in the alcoves.
Okay.
How long is that going to take?
Pretty much a thorough search of a room is going to take about 10 minutes each. And you're at 41 right now.
So we'll each split off into two groups, and you guys can do one room, and the other ones can do another room.
Or we can just go through the automaton and see what's in there.
Let's save that for all of us together. Because if we find the secret door in one of the other rooms and whatever, we don't bother with it.
I will aid in the search.
Okay. I get a plus one perception in Shadow Sight, so I feel like I should probably be searching and get aided.
Okay, so who's going to which alcove to do these searches? So we have our teams.
Yeah, Fringe,
go to the second one.
Fringe and Teapot on the second one, and then Miss Teller and Kane will do the other one.
Okay. And you can throw in a boon for Vigdis being in there too, even though he's got a hunch in. And
all right.
So Fringe will make one with one boon, and Abigail will make one with two boons.
17.
13.
All right. So both of you look around these alcoves. You don't see anything that indicates that there would be a secret entrance or exit from these rooms.
All right. Now we can
go. 51 minutes, everybody.
You're 51 minutes.
Axe hands.
Yeah, let's
Teapot leave. Cannot believe that he is about to suggest this. But do you want me to see if I can walk back to the cage? Because if this is a magical construct, if he's, depending on what his senses are like, if he's looking for, I don't know, heartbeats, heat, I have none of these things.
Stand on my shoulder, I say, and then I will open up my glass cage and slowly begin to creep forward.
I think this is a bad idea. We should leave with the information we have, turn it in, and just be done.
Well, I'm just talking about looking for a second or additional door, but, you know.
Because, I mean,
we're just going to go.
He's going to show up. If he's going to show up otherwise in the middle of it, and I'd rather just go before he shows up, because I feel like we have the evidence we need. We've done what we need.
He's not going to show up in the middle of it. There's six rounds in a minute.
We have 9 minutes left before he shows up.
The fight's not going to go more than 10 rounds.
I am leaving to avoid combat. Especially if we're going to go straight from fighting big, ugly, scary, axe-handed monster to fighting a potential necromancer who's got enough power, who's got enough juice to store souls for more than a few hours.
Can Fringe hear people when she has the thing open, or does her...
No, it's completely silent.
So you guys are, like, debating it, and she's just like...
Yeah, these are all the reasons you shouldn't do it, and everything's completely silent. So it is still possible for him to see you, but because you are silent, I will give you 3 boons to your stealth challenge roll.
Awesome. Do I have any other stealthy things? And it maxes out of 3 boons, right, that you can't have anymore.
Yeah. And well, you only add the highest one, but.
Oh, well, yeah. All right. So plus one.
Teapot, are you still riding Fringe's shoulder?
I'm pretty sure. I'm not sure if I can hear things while I'm in contact with her. I don't know how that works.
No.
So
as long as the little door on the birdcage is open and you're touching her, you can't hear anything either.
There you go then. So I'm just sitting on her shoulders.
Still go on record as this is a bad idea.
37. Agreed. I rolled a natural 20 and 2 sixes.
Wow. Wow. So yeah,
I become a fucking ghost.
You kind of hug the wall, and for some reason, I don't want to like lessen the competency, but it just amuses me to think you could knock over a ton of shit, and that doesn't matter as long as it doesn't look at you. But you basically hug the wall so that you're not in its field of vision, and you walk straight past the thing, and like all of you guys in the outside of the hallway, you don't see where Fringe is at all, but you do see that the automaton just keeps looking straight towards the end of the hallway and does not start axing anything. So you guys are at the end of the hallway. There's no noise until you close the birdcage, so it's up to you whether you can start conversing or not. But you do notice as you get to the end of the row, the elf can't hear anything and doesn't notice you, but she notices that everything is silent because she's very good at noticing that, you know, like she hears the squeaks of the gears turning in the automaton and all of that. So she's kind of like looking around perplexed because she can't hear anything right now.
I will motion to Teapot to get off my shoulder and open the cage. And like I'll put my finger to my lips, like be very quiet. Actually, I'll reach over so you can open. He doesn't have to get off of me. I'll just like motion for you to walk on my arm. But I don't want to touch the cage because it's cold iron.
Yeah. And then you would suddenly look like a bag of twigs and mud.
Yeah, exactly.
Which might freak out. I don't know if it'd freak out Teapot.
Teapot will see if he can get the door open.
Okay. Give me an agility-based...
I'll give you my lockpicks.
Go for it. Yeah, that'll be your phone.
Yeah. And I do have murder, so I'm somewhat sneaky in my professions.
You know what? I'm going to say murderer probably involves sneaking into people's rooms once in a while, so I will give you a boon for the tools and a boon for the profession.
Nice. That would be 19.
Okay. So the door clicks open. The elf is still...
The door doesn't click open. Mine is clicking open.
Yeah. I mean, you can feel it kind of click, but yeah, it doesn't make any noise. And she looks oddly at you. She kind of turns her head sideways and she's like pantomiming towards things.
Fingers. The small winged creature gestures for her to be silent.
And all of the faces are doing this like weird like.
And Mother Bastion reaches out her hand to her, like, you know, join us.
Like, withdraws from you because they are very Inquisition-looking robes.
I make motions with my fingers like we're going to walk away, you know? Like, and then, you know, my hands, like, gesture for her to come.
She's going to follow you. You get the feeling she's going to follow you, but she does not want you touching her.
Okay, then I will, like, point to the birdcage and then make like I'm screaming. To make it clear that I'm unable to make noise because of the birdcage.
Okay.
So I'll be like, while pointing at the birdcage, and then stop, put my hand in my ear.
She picks up on your pantomime that this is a magical thing that is dampening sound because she's an elf and she understands that sort of weird, you know, that sort of magical effect. So she will stay about a pace away from you. As, you know, because she can kind of gauge how far, you know, the sounds are dying out around you so that she's not touching anyone. Right. You do, I mean, when you unlock her and get her out of this, you notice she's got no clothing or anything. I mean, she's just been thrown in here without any means of potentially using clothing as a means of attacking someone or anything like that. So
I got clothing in my back.
For his cloak.
Well,
we'll take off his cloak and give it to her.
Let me point out.
It's a bikini size.
She's not happy if someone else imposes it on her, but she's also a fake, you know, elf. She's not that shy about this either. It's just more the indignity of someone not allowing her to choose whether or not she can wear clothing that upsets her.
A teapot cloak is a half cloak for her. She can decide how exposed she wants to be.
Just tie it around her hip there. And. So she follows you guys out. So give me another stealth check with three boons.
Oh, only a 15 that time.
Okay. So scooting around the corner, like all of a sudden they all pop out around the side of the door, the hallway, and all of you guys see these people and the elf is with you. Do you close
the door?
Are you closing the hallway door? The hallway door or the birdcage door?
The door to the hallway.
Okay. So the door closes. Are you closing the birdcage door?
Are we out with them now and out of the reach of that guy? Okay, well, if we're out of danger, then I'll open the birdcage and it'll be like, are there any secret entrances or exits from the room that we just left?
Not that I have ever been shown. Who are you people? Why are you down here? Is this some sort of trick? Is this some sort of head game that you people are trying against me? I've already told you anything useful that you need to know now.
Okay, number one, we have no idea who you are.
Fridge will throw up her hands in the air and say, she's useless, I will watch from the outside. And then she okay, agrees so to do the thing you guys asked her to do like 10 minutes ago. Properly.
And explain, we're here because we're afraid of corruption in the church. And the fact that you're here tells me that there is corruption in the church. What exactly happened to you?
French, can we use your cloak? your Inquisitor robe, since you can hide really well. That way we don't have a random naked elf walking out with us.
Oh no. Absolutely not. But she can have my rags, and I will pull out some basic clothing from my backpack that she can have.
There's probably clothing in the office or something down here, right? Somewhere? Maybe?
Oh, actually, no. I'll give her the cultist robe. No, I need the cultist robe and mask I have. I take that back. I'm using
Abby
that.
Will have a Abby has a cloak in her bag. She will offer it to the elf.
All right. She will put it on.
For leaving purposes.
If you would. Does your cloak have a hood on it?
It does, because it's what I use to hide from the rain.
Okay. So, in other words, it would be easier for her to hide her elfness using
yes.
this. So, Abigail, give me a social test. As you're trying to...
Okay, that's not bad. 16.
All right. So she looks at you and she goes, she actually believes that you might be not with the Inquisition. And she's like, oh, so you're stealing from the Inquisition. That is a interesting proposition. I still do not believe I can trust you, but I can definitely get behind causing problems for these rotten bastards that have kept me locked up here for the last few years.
Okay, why were they why did they keep you locked up here?
Essentially, and here's my caveat here. I'm going to say that you can get away with three questions before it starts adding significantly to the time, just so that I had kind of a limiter, because I know that I'm not speaking in real time as far as what's going on here.
Yes.
So, beyond three questions, it will start adding time, but right now... And also the time to the hallway and back and getting her freed, we are up to 56 minutes.
Elsewhere.
Yeah, we need to leave, but I need to know why were they holding her here, because that will determine what we, you know, where we go first.
And she tells you that she was captured because she has been investigating the three witches in the Forest of Screams at the same time that the Inquisitors were investigating this thing, and she was taken prisoner as part of their investigation about the three witches of the Screaming Forest.
Does that sound familiar to me?
Yeah, you've probably heard legends about the three witches of the Forest of Screams, because these are not like witches like... These are witches the way commoners view witches, like evil people that use evil, you know, females that use terrible spells that do things that you shouldn't, as opposed to, you know, practitioners of your particular brand of magic.
Okay. And
they are rumored to have all sorts of traffic with devils, and to be doing horrible things in their forest, and nothing comes back out of their forest without being horribly scarred or maimed or mutated or experimented on by them.
Got it. This elf was in the forest being experimented on.
No, she was investigating what they were up to because she thought that they had some vital information.
Ah.
So that is one question.
All right, so then we have the... She was investigating at the same time as the Inquisition.
Who was she investigating for?
Exactly.
The elders of the Fey realms that border this region of human lands sent me to find out anything that is potentially dangerous or wider reaching in the world that might touch upon this area. So when the lords and ladies of my particular court sent me out, they were concerned about the upheavals that have been caused by the human empire falling apart. So that's two questions.
All right.
Oh, and also, from what she tells you, you can glean she is a knight errant among the Fey courts.
Should we ask her if she's seen the bishop do anything untoward to as a bishop? You know what I'm saying?
Or with souls?
Yeah.
Yeah.
If you add with souls, it changes her answer quite a bit, because... The means of questioning that she has been inflicted upon her is not pleasant. But if you mention Of Souls, she only mentions that she, that the bishop was extremely interested in finding out about what supernatural creatures that traffic in such things would do, using souls as currency and what you could purchase with them.
Oh, so he was. Oh, and Teapot does say that.
So, yeah, what you glean from this is he may not know a lot about souls. He was trying to figure out what their values were. Basically, he was trying to figure out if she understood the exchange rate of using souls as currency. And okay, that is your three questions. Would you like to try and head back out with your 56 minutes?
Yes.
And since I have an interesting profession, we'd like to use a little bit of subterfuge to get the elf out. And of course, there are people who like many strange things, and women wearing bandanas is one of them that I keep in my bag. So I put one over her head, so, Taylor, cover your ears up with this and put on this kind of pant. And then you kind of look like a person who has an impure profession, as I've been called several times.
And she like cocks her head and she goes, "How can you have an impure profession? You humans are so odd."
Yes, we are.
So you dressing her up doesn't take that much time, but you are up to your kind of your limit. So this is going to see how well it takes you, how long it takes you to talk your way past the guard. So as an inventory here, you have the box with the signs carved into it that you signed, correct?
Yes.
And you have the elf who doesn't necessarily look like an elf, but it's an extra person that you didn't have previously.
Yes, we're going to run with the story that he has bound a harlot downstairs in his dungeon and has had locked her up away. And hopefully the guards don't actually know this. They don't know what's in there.
So as you come up the stairs, one of the guards is gone because he's the one that went to go get the bishop.
Okay.
This guard is looking at you, and as you're coming up the stairs, he goes, "I understood from the letter that you would not be taking anything out. You would just be performing a regular audit. Who is that woman, and why are you taking that out?"
That is a matter for the Inquisition. Heresy.
I will smack him, and I will say, "Do not speak to the guard of private matters." I will. I know what would be the appropriate thing to say. You forget yourself, sir. And slap. There we go. Do not speak to the guard of these private matters. And I'll turn to the guard and say, "It is not for you to know."
Crap.
Okay. So that is the approach you're using. That.
Well, isn't that what Mother Bastion's kind of like? I got that.
Yes.
Well, yeah. I mean, here's the thing. Because you have two things that you're taking out, you will have two banes on your social test.
Oh, that's not good.
To talk your way past this. Do you have any professions that would add?
I don't, but I have my trickery.
She is with the hero of the town for a boon.
There you go. So it's only, you're down to only one bane because everyone has heard about what Teapot did to rouse those cultists by fooling them into thinking that they had real orphans in the room somehow.
I have trickery. I can use that.
Okay.
So that's two.
And then me adding in, just kind of reading the guard to see, to try to help, explain things through why we need these things.
So you've erased
Ruffle.
You've erased the other ones and added one boon. So make your social test with one boon.
All right. It's intellect.
Mm-hmm.
All right, so plus one. One plus one d6. Ah, no, I got eight.
Dang it.
So the guard stands in front of you and goes, I am sorry, m'lady. I do not wish to overstep my bounds with a member of the Inquisition. However, as I work directly for the bishop, and he will be here any moment, I am afraid I must insist we wait until the bishop arrives.
I'm afraid I must insist that there are 1, 2, 3, 4, 6 of us and one of you.
here's the thing. You got 3 minutes to potentially, like, cut this guy down and go, if you want to go that route.
Well, I mean, we'll probably cut him down, and then I will replace
Abby
him.
Abby would heal him.
Oh, right. Of course.
Or hey, we could.
Look, right as we're talking about cutting someone down.
Your hair looks much better.
Vignes wants to hit somebody. Who are we hitting?
I guess that tears it.
Vignes is carrying the chest, though.
I will,
one-handed.
Likes that.
No, I will say, not. Okay, all right. Allow me to share with you the secret of why we must be so expedient. I'll lean into him.
Okay.
And then I will whisper to him that his soul will suffer greatly as I stab him with a dagger using my trickery.
Oh, crap.
All right. Do you have any kind of, like, murdering or assassination talent to use instead of general combat talent, since this is before combat starts?
No, I just have trickery. That's my only other thing is I was a tracker. I don't think that would
come. All right, so make your attack on him.
All right.
Vignes is probably going to need to squash this guy.
He likes that plan, too. who am I squishing?
The guard.
Oh, and I rolled
not to kill him. We just want to knock him out.
So I missed by a lot. I imagine he has a higher AC than a 9 defense, rather.
Yes. Yes, he does.
The chest that I'm carrying, is it breakable?
You're not carrying it. Teapot
has it. Okay.
Teapot will not hand that chest to anybody.
Yeah, you probably don't
club break that one's name on it.
Okay, so the quick upshot was you guys got hired to ransack the bishop's dungeons to find incriminating things. You have an elf that he had in his dungeons and a box full of souls. And now one of the guards is upset because you guys were taking something out of the dungeons, even though you had a letter letting you audit the dungeons. And you have about 2 minutes until the bishop and more guards show up. So you have a time limit on how fast you want to take this guy out.
I'm assuming that we're okay. They're okay with whatever level of force we need here, or
it's up to you guys how you want to interpret that.
We're not murderers.
We're not murderers.
We kill people.
Well, no, actually, I'm trying to point out. Yeah. I don't want to. I don't want
to have murderer in our job title.
I don't want to speak for Vignes, but I'm pretty sure Vignes would immediately jump on that distinction of murdering someone is killing them before they're aware of you.
Yeah, that is a fair distinction.
He knows you're there. It's not murder.
Yeah.
This is just a fight.
And even if he was aware, murder's kind of a gray area.
So, yes. So now that Mother Bastion, which is not Mother Bastion, but actually Fringe, has just attempted to kill him, we are going to go into initiative. So anyone that would like to take a fast turn, you're all pretty much within arm's reach of this guy at this point because you're just coming up the stairs. The areas right now are, you are at the gates of the estate. The gardens are another area inside the estate. The city streets are on the other side of the gate, and the stairs are going down. So those are your areas for this fight.
Hmm.
So you guys are all at the gates of the estate right now with him.
I will take a fast turn, but I'll go last.
Okay.
So could I conceivably knock this guy down the stairs?
You could. You could attempt to.
Okay.
I would say if you can,
like a driving attack.
Yeah. If you would like to make a driving attack, there is a chance he falls down the stairs. Of course, you go after him, but you know.
you, use Overbear as an action that allows you to move and then push the guy. You don't do any attack damage, right. But it...
Yes, you could do that as well.
Abby has a plan.
Yeah.
She'd like to bewitch him and make him move up to his speed down the stairs.
Okay. Would you like to go first then?
I would.
Okay.
So this is an intellect attack roll versus his intellect.
All right. What did you get?
17.
Oddly, his intellect is not 17. So.
All right. And I say, go down the stairs and look for yourself.
That sounds like a great idea, he says in a slightly dreamy tone and walks down the stairs.
Now we slam the door shut and bar them behind him.
So that was, so you took a fast turn, so you just cast the spell. who else would like to take a fast turn? Because you'll have to be able to move to the stairs and then do this. Because actually he hasn't wandered over there yet. He's going to.
What are we trying to do to this guy? Are we trying to knock him out or...
Yeah, no, we're going to get him down the stairs and bar him in.
And bar him in, okay.
Then we don't have to kill him.
So basically, at the end of the fast turn, he's going to walk down there.
Or kill him because he knows who we are and we were here. And if so we kill him,
would anyone else like to take a fast turn before he walks down the stairs? Because he's going to take a fast turn to walk down the stairs at the end of all this.
Like I said, I will go last, but before that guy.
Okay.
Teapot's taking the slow action.
Okay.
Yeah, Vegas is taking slow as well.
Okay. Kane?
I'm just going to take a slow. I'm just going to not do anything right now. Okay. We'll see, I guess. I'll just take a slow action. Yeah.
Fringe, what would you like to do before he walks down the stairs?
Yeah. So it seems like we've elected not to kill him. So instead, I'm just going to try to steal from him.
Okay. Of course.
Whatever is of value. He's probably got a sword, right? I'll take that. And I'll try to go for his pockets, too.
Okay. In front of him.
Well, didn't you just charming spell him or whatever? I'm not a fucking mage. Does he look all enchanted?
You know, if we kill him, I can buy a four-hour head start.
I assume that he starts to zombily turn towards the stairs and stuff. Is that?
I think it's still just he just does the one thing that she asks.
Oh,
it doesn't completely. He's not completely blank. It's just he has this compulsion to do that one thing that she.
And he hasn't drawn his sword yet.
No, he was still just awesome. You know.
Well, then, yeah, I'll take his sword for sure because that's worth a couple gold.
Okay,
at least silver.
So give me a test, but this one is actually going to be against his defense because it's in combat.
I will use my trickery. 14.
That does not get past his defense. Aww. His large shield is kind of in the way of his.
Oh, well, that, can I take the large shield?
That is strapped to his arm.
Oh, okay.
So, no.
Actually, I do want to take a fast turn.
You have failed your thievery, good sir.
Good
man. So, okay, he walks down the stairs. That's the end Jared? Of the fast turn. So now we're on four turns.
Jared? So, Vegas would like to take a fast turn beforehand because I just read what Shove does.
Okay.
Vignes says, yeah, go downstairs. And he's going to try and just shove this guy down.
Okay.
Okay. So I get a boon on this because I'm larger than this guy.
Yes.
And it's I roll against his strength.
Okay.
So let's see here. Rolled, not great. Well, I rolled 12, 16.
Okay, that is enough.
Okay, so this guy goes flying 5 yards down the stairs.
Okay. He goes spiraling down the stairs, and he's going to take some damage from that. All right. So that puts him at... at that. And he is laying down the stairs, so... now he feels as if the compulsion has been met because he went down the stairs. He's not quite sure what happened because he went down a lot faster than he was planning. So that's the end of the fast turn. So now we're on slow turns. So Teapot and Kane, you can still take slow turns. Vigdis just shoved him down the stairs.
I am going to wave at the elf to follow me, and I am going to move as far as I possibly can away from this area.
Okay.
On this turn.
Okay, so you can move, you're at the gates of the estate, you can move to the city streets and then out into an alleyway if you want to.
That'd be great. I will ask the elf for my cloak back so I can use it to cover the box.
Okay. All right, so, Kane.
I'm at the door, I can shut and lock the door and then move her.
I will say on a slow turn, you could probably shut them and bar them.
Okay, that's fine. I'll see that.
All right, so that is only one turn. You still have about a minute for the rest of you to vacate this this estate before the bishop and whatever reinforcements he called shows up.
Run like hell.
Done.
So here's the question. Since you're very close and there's people on the estate that could have their eyes on you, those two already like took off across the street and nobody was thinking much about that. The rest of you, since they're just about to show up, either, if you would like, give me a stealth challenge roll to see if you're just being inconspicuous, or come up with some other reason that you would be inconspicuous and leaving the estate. That doesn't mean that you won't get away before the bishop shows up. It's just whether people notice you, since especially some of you are a little noteworthy in your appearance.
Is there any like a box or a barrel or a crate or something in the like the yard between here and where we're leaving?
Give me a perception test.
That's going to be challenging. Two. That's a crate.
So I'm going to say you actually did find something, but you like picked it up and it fell apart because it's like got dry rot and somebody hasn't been taking care of it. So you go to pick this thing up and it just like falls apart in your hands.
How?
Yeah, my plan is to look like a porter, but I just sort of shrug and start walking off the property.
Yeah, okay. I'm going to go that route too. Put my hat back in my bag. but yeah, just kind of walk out officially.
Okay, so in this case, I'm going to say it's a stealth test, but it's not necessarily stealth so much as just kind of blending in with the crowd on the street as you're walking out of the gates.
Well, right. I will go in the opposite direction of the party and make more of a spectacle of myself before actually going to ground.
Okay. Because you look like Mother Bastion.
Correct.
Ooh, would that grant us a boon then?
That was my idea, yeah.
Yeah, I think so. I think so. So yeah.
Now is this a...
loudly saying, yes, I am leaving now because I had every reason to be here.
I'll yell about how it was like an intellect-based stealth roll.
You know what? I think if you would like to argue you're being sneaky, it would be agility. If you're going to argue that you're trying to blend in with the crowd, you could use intellect if you would like.
I am going to go with blending.
Okay.
And I get my boon from Fringe, right?
Yes, as I shout about how this is an affront to the Inquisition and how I've never been so deeply offended. I'll like toss in some dark speech curses for good measure.
Because everybody knows Mother Bastion speaks dark speech a lot.
Of course she does.
So,
Jared, I'd like a ruling. I think because Vignus is so big, I imagine he's going to get a bane on his stealth. But I'm going to make a pitch for, because he's a thrall, I'm assuming that he spent most of his life trying to not draw the attention of the other Jotun.
Yeah,
I'm wondering if I can balance out.
Oh yeah, you can throw in a boon for that profession because you're used to doing all. I'm just a servant here. I'm supposed to be here. Yeah, that sort of thing.
Okay. So I think I'm just rolling with one net boon then. Oh, it's a 19.
You rolled better than me.
Well, this is my, I thank my House Karita dice as well.
Oh, man. Yeah, so yeah, Vig just, I mean, people noticed that there was a Jotun here, but you definitely looked like you were supposed to be here doing some work, and... Oh, it's a Jotun.
Not shoving guards. Definitely not shoving guards.
Somebody shilled out some extra money to hire a Jotun to do some work. That makes sense.
I rolled a 6 on my die, plus 2 for my intellect, and 5 on my boon. So I just made it.
Just scraping by.
Yes.
So basically...
Go ahead.
Everybody gets out of there relatively nonchalant. Nobody really notices you, except for Mother Bastion, that everybody noticed Mother Bastion. But at this point, is Fringe going to attempt to, like, duck around the corner and shift out of Mother Bastion shape?
Yeah, I'll give them, like, half a minute to do their thing, and then I'll duck around the corner and assume the shape of somebody I just, you know, I'm losing eyesight on.
Yeah, just somebody walking down the street. And,
then I'll save my Inquisitor clothing. And put on my cultist robes so that I'm not, you know, noticeable.
Okay, so you put on your nice black and gray silk cultist robes, and
okay. Well, I don't imagine they're very nice anymore, but yeah.
Yeah.
Most of what the Inquisition investigates in this city is actually just Fringe.
Probably.
I'm picturing like Fringe has actually found real cultists, but because Fringe is following those cultists, the Inquisition is actually following Fringe around, so they never find the real cultists. Oh, man. Okay, so all of you managed to get out here nonchalantly. You do know that, you know, Mother Bastion wants you to meet up there again this evening at the same church. So is there anything you're doing in between now and meeting back up with Mother Bastion?
Switch identities a few times.
Get rid of the Inquisition robes. Ball them up, hide them in my bag so that when I take them back to the church, I'm going to just be like, here, I don't like these.
Okay. And the elf that is with Teapot at the moment, she is like, where do you plan on taking me?
I don't plan on taking you anywhere. I think that you've done your part for the church. If you want to hang out with my friends and I, you're welcome to. If you don't, you know, remember us fondly.
I would return to my people as soon as possible. I appreciate you letting me free. And she tells you, if you ever happen upon the Feylands in this particular region, if you invoke her name, they may not kill you.
Nice.
Me.
May not.
Well, it's you know, it's fey creatures. It gives you better odd than you would have had. So
does this elf have a name?
Well, elves do not give you their names. They give you their nicknames because fey do not casually hand out their names. But if you invoke the name of Starsinger, they will know that you are speaking of a knight of the Fey Court, and if they have the inclination, they will not treat you the way they would if you didn't drop her name, which is about as much of a promise as you can give.
Just in case, to make sure it doesn't get lost later on, I will pass that information around to everybody else in the team as well.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Yeah. Does the elf meet back up with everybody else?
It depends. I mean, if you planned on meeting outside of the church, she's not going to go into the church.
Oh, no, I wouldn't ask her to. I was just thinking to get her some clothes that would hide her identity very well.
If you had a meetup place that you were going, that you already agreed on before the church.
Yeah, we didn't think that far in advance.
Does that sound like us? Come on.
She does before she leaves. Well, if you didn't have one in advance, she's just going to say her goodbyes to Teapot. But she does say, "I really hope that at some point in time you learn how to undo the troll spell, because that would be a boon to everyone in this world.
The troll spell?
Yes, the troll spell.
Which troll spell?
You don't know about the troll spell?
I don't know a troll spell.
You struck me as a wise and ancient being that would know such things ahead of time.
Do I know anything about the troll spell, Jared? You tell me.
You know nothing about the troll spell.
Yeah, most of my time was spent elsewhere, not so much here.
She looks at you and she goes, "They're dangerous, but if you really want to know about the troll spell, the three witches would be able to answer your questions."
All right, so three witches are now on my list of people to go see.
And then, like, you turn around and she does the Batman thing where you... Mm-hmm. So, now the three of you, before you go into the church, you may not have had a meeting place before the church, but at least outside of the church, all of you can meet back up with one another. So, what do you say before you go back into this meeting?
I'll give them the name of the elf in case they're in the Feylands. There's a troll spell, apparently, that we need to go see the three witches for. And, that's all Teapot's going to tell them.
Vigdis asks Abby if she knows these witches.
I do not.
He looks confused.
Don't all witches know each other?
Maybe a little prejudiced towards witches. He assumes you all know each other.
While it's a small circle of people, it's still larger than one person to have met them all.
Mm. So before you enter the church, everyone give me a perception test.
Okay. Yep. Yay.
No.
Maybe it's thinking really hard about that witch's coven.
12.
Okay.
Perception, it's your intellect bonus, right?
Yes.
8.
Okay.
17.
Okay, so Cain and Abigail noticed this. Cain and Abigail noticed this, but no one else really, picks up on this. Fringe, I assume, I didn't hear your...
I got a 6, so I fell. Okay.
So, Cain, you look across the street and you see what appears to be a female form, like, hanging near one of the alleyways. And she's kind of, like, gesturing with her hand like this. Abigail, you see that same person, but you hear a voice in your mind as she's gesturing. And she is saying, "Dear Abigail, you have information on the bishop?"
Oh, crap.
And the voice in your head matches the woman with the blue fingertips and the lips that you encountered over the last month.
Oh, I don't like her. Perhaps, what's it to you?
Anything incriminating about the bishop would be better served with our sisterhood than to turn it over to anyone else in the church. Don't you agree?
This is too political.
If Vigdis had heard this, he would have said that maybe she can introduce you to the three witches. But of course he didn't hear that.
Oh man.
Yeah, this is a cruel, cruel joke on me as a player. It's like orders and me don't get along very well. We've been through this one. I'm going to say the church and you can have the information. But the church needs to root out their own corruption to prove themselves.
It would be much better if we were the ones pulling all the strings, but as you wish. You still know where to meet me if you change your mind about joining us.
Fair enough. Thank you.
So, Cain, you saw this going on and you notice, like, Abigail seems to be, like, looking in that direction and thinking real hard. What do you do?
It's really none of my business at this point. So probably. Just let it go unless I hear about it or something.
Okay. So are you all going to enter into the church?
Mm-hmm. Teapot is going to immediately seek up when he gets there. He wants to be at least 15 feet off the floor.
Okay, so you fly straight up to, like, the upper reaches of the ceiling. I mean, this isn't like a cathedral or anything. It's just kind of a regular... It's a nicer church, but it's not like a big grand edifice, so...
So he's going to play gargoyle again.
Yes. So you find your gargoyle first.
With the box. Good idea.
As you walk in, you notice Mother Bastion is here. And she also has another person with her wearing robes similar to hers, which are Inquisition-like, but not identical to the Inquisition. And she goes, oh, it is wonderful that you have come back to me. What have you found out?
All right. Who wants to do the talking?
And first she motions over to the bodyguard, and the bodyguard has like a chest next to him, and he picks up one sack that he throws out there, which is just the ten silver shillings to begin with. Because she knows you got something because they had people watching the estate.
Of course, because of course they did.
Yeah, fucking micromanagers. Jeez.
So what do you have for me? I am so excited about this.
Before we go into this too much, because Teapot doesn't want to unilaterally make this or I don't want to unilaterally make this decision for the party. The souls are going to be very good currency, especially if we're dealing with evil witches. Teapot, as a character, has very strong feelings about imprisoned souls that are not eventually let go. I am willing to overlook that and keep the currency, because Teapot is fully intending to otherwise, you know, when we talk about the fact that we found the souls, be like, yeah, we found this box, and dump the souls on the floor so that the glass shatters and they can see their souls, and then the souls are released. I don't want to unilaterally make that decision.
Now, I will say, as far as, like, you guys can have your own personal beliefs, but culturally, if you are an adherent to the church, yes, binding souls is a terrible thing. Witches are not particularly positive on keeping souls bound up, because that's not part of their magic. And even like the Jotun, like, keeping souls away from being able to either prove their value in Valhalla or to go to the underworld and be reborn is...
Well, yeah, I think
what Vegas... against their weird. That's, you know...
Yeah, that's what Vegas thinks, is that, like, if you explain what these things are, I think the way Vegas understands it is that these beings aren't free to pursue their weird. You know, their fate. So he is probably not a fan of that. But he is a fan of money. But he's probably more, I don't know. You know, I'm going to roll randomly to let that determine.
Abby's going to go on the direction of, as much as, yes, it would probably be great currency for the evil witches, I can't see keeping a bound soul.
Yeah, Vegas is with her on that.
So I'm going to say, yeah, let's free the souls and let them either go to hell or go to heaven. Take their pick.
Okay.
Again, if people want it, I will bow to that. That's not a big deal. I don't want to make this decision on my own.
What does Fringe think about this?
Fringe thinks she's already got 9 silver out of this, and selling the soul would be more work than it's worth.
I like how simple it is to understand Fringe.
The Teapot will go with his original plan.
Okay. Since so what you have brought her, Teapot says, look, he had bound souls and you dumped them on the floor?
Yes.
Okay.
And I open the box so that the actual jars make contact with the floor.
Yes. So you have this crash on the floor. You hear this... it initially sounds like a scream, but then it kind of turns into like this sigh of relief as the... as the greenish glowing mist starts to kind of like swirl up and dissipate on the air. Since everyone agreed to this, everyone can remove 2 corruption.
Whoa.
I'm not that cool anymore. Yay.
One corruption or
from a church again.
Yeah, you can't have a negative corruption score. So if you only had 1 corruption, you're just at 0. But yes.
I'm at 0. Wait, I've never gotten any corruption.
I'm down to 7.
Oh god.
So she looks at those and for a second she seems upset that you just destroyed evidence. But she does notice, like, the jars still have the inscription on them, and the box still has those. And she goes, "And you found this in the bishop's dungeons?"
Yep.
This will be worthwhile evidence. I wish you had kept them intact, but I do understand why you would be offended by them, and it offends me as well. I just, you know, souls being bound for a few more weeks wouldn't have been horrible, but I understand it removes the temptation for anyone to use them in an untoward fashion. I totally understand that. And she motions over to the bodyguard.
Actually, I got a role play moment for Vigdis with that. He's just, you know, sort of like itching where the thrall chain used to be. He only someone who hasn't been bound would think that any extra time would not be an undue burden.
And she looks at you. I think part of what you, if you, depending on how good you are at reading people, but you almost see like she doesn't expect that deep of a thought coming from you, because up to this point, you have been sort of like Abby's, you're an extension of Abby. This is what Abby uses to hit people with.
and Abby greatly appreciates that of Vigdis.
He needs a nap and a sandwich after this, but
I think we can arrange that.
So she motions over to the bodyguard, and he reaches into the chest and grabs another thing and tosses it out there, and you see there's like 25 more silver shillings in there in addition to the first 10. Have you brought me anything else?
So outside of this, do we want to explain what with the 3 witches and the elf?
Sure.
You do want to? Because we have the paperwork that we found, because we have the ledger thing and the list of blackmails.
Fringe will ask which of you has brought the elf with you.
Oh.
Well, the elf was allowed to be free and go back to their land.
There was an elf?
Yes, bound in an iron cage and beaten.
Well, yes, but I mean, there was, what was the controversy? I'm sure that, you know, there were reasons he could have for wanting to imprison someone and get questions from them, so.
He was researching the witches of the Screaming Forest, I believe, in order to make a trade for the souls.
Vigna says there were 3 of them.
Oh, the witches in the Screaming Forest? What? He was talking to an elf about negotiating with the witches of the Screaming Forest. That is ridiculous. And I really wish that you had brought this elf to me. I mean, it would have been much more useful if proper inquisitors could have gotten some more answers out of her. However, this is valuable information.
Or you can hire us to do it.
Or sent proper inquisitors.
Well, I'm one of the...
Are we not proper inquisitors?
and as Fringe asks that, Abby's going to pull the inquisitor robes out and put them on the table and go, "No, I'm not an inquisitor."
So she looks and she goes, it was valuable, however, to learn this as well. And she takes, she has another bag, and this one adds 10 more silver shillings to the amount there.
Are we going to provide the ledgers, Kane?
Yeah, pass over the ledgers and the list.
And she starts paging through that, and she goes, "Ah, now this is extremely valuable, because it's not just it's not just implied evidence that we can use to make the bishop uncomfortable. This is actually written in his own handiwork. We can use spells to verify that he is the one that was filling out these ledgers, and we can follow up on all of these people that were bribed. This is wonderful. Thank you so much. And she gushes over you almost to the point to where you feel dirty. And
I already do.
And the final bag that she throws in there is another 50 silver shillings.
Whoa.
Holy crap.
Vigdis looks at the bigger thing, and then he kind of looks at her with like expectant eyes and says, "And we didn't kill anyone."
And she thinks about that for a moment, and she goes, "That is surprising," but she doesn't add anything.
Vigdis looks a little disappointed.
yeah, in Vigdis's mind, this is just like, oh, should have killed somebody. No difference one way or the other.
Nonviolence, come on.
Oh, man. So I believe that's, what is that, 10?
105.
Yeah, I got 105.
Yes, that is your total to distribute amongst yourselves. And they threw all the bags in between you, so you were all very cognizant of exactly how much you were getting paid.
I say we each get 26 silver shillings and call it a day.
Teapot will only take 5. He doesn't eat.
Wait, sorry, 26?
Yeah, 105 divided by 5 is 26.
Isn't it 21? Oh, yeah.
Yeah, you're right. 21.
You have 100 divided by 4.
Yeah.
So you each get...
25. Okay, nice.
I now have 34 silver. Nice.
Yay, I now have 26 silver shillings. Yay!
What am I doing?
I'm rich.
All of you? Yeah. Well, I was going to say, for your current station in life, this is quite a bit of wealth here.
Mm-hmm. Yes, it is.
What do you plan on doing after this meeting? Because Mother Bastion is like, I must go make plans. Please forgive my abruptness, but I must go begin working on what I'm going to do with this information in order to help save the bishop's soul and to make the church a more secure place. And you definitely get the implication. She's not just going to like turn this over to church hierarchs to get him like turned over. You get the feeling this is definitely blackmail information that she's going to be acting on.
Yep. So after the meeting, is the place to meet Miss Bluefingers in town?
Yes.
Especially knowing that she's going to be using blackmail material, I don't like that.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that someone needs to act as a counterbalance to what she's going to be doing. And I know the information, but I'm not going to provide everything.
Okay.
But I would say that she's going to be sending people out to hunt down people to blackmail for the church.
Okay. So you meet with her and she goes, "Abigail, I am so thrilled that you have decided to share this information with us. This is the first step in the right direction. We are going to make this world a better place. People are going to understand how things should run properly. And I would just like to thank you once again for providing us with this information. We will not waste this. We will make sure that the right people are in power in the right places."
Yeah, that's the problem. Everybody wants the right people in the right places of power. We want a balance.
So you give her that information, so she will start having her people work on looking into getting this information, because now they know the right place to start looking. So she thanks you for that. The rest of you, I don't know if you want to carouse, get rooms, whatever else you're going to be doing. The next adventure that we will be doing next week will not, this is only going to be about a month's time in between these two. So it's not going to be the big year break. It's just going to be like, you guys have some time to settle in and spend some cash. However, the other noteworthy thing that happens before all of this ends is when's the first time that Kane would be alone?
Fairly soon, I think, where it's not like we all live together or anything, or we're, it's like Abigail already took off, so whenever she takes off, the group can't break up.
Okay, so I guess what I'm really pointing at is, like, you would have a place to stay that's separate from everyone else, and, you know, some night when you curl up to go to bed and you fall asleep, in your head, you see this glorious, shining being. Absolutely, you know, the most attractive being that you have ever seen, and it has these shining golden wings, and radiant beams are coming off of this creature. And it looks at you and says, "Kane, you have been associated with people that do not fully understand the mission of the church. Mother Bastion is correct that you have been chosen by the new god. However, you have been chosen especially to root out this corruption. You need to keep an eye on all of this that's going on, and if you ever need my help, all you need to do is to utter my name, and I will appear and help you for as long as I can."
Does he say what his name is?
Yes. The being, which you can only assume is an angel, tells you its name is Elendariel. And you must speak its name aloud in a prayer so that people can hear its name, and it will appear before you.
His name is Joe Totally Not McEvil.
The new god wants you to be the true force for good here. You need to keep an eye on all of these webs of these dastardly spiders going on, and I will help you do that.
Do they tell me these spiders on her?
Well, you get the feeling, you know, since it mentioned Mother Bastion, that it does not think that Mother Bastion has the interests of the church, the better interests of the church in mind. And, you know, you also get the feeling that probably the bishop is another issue there. So you are special. You understand the church better than anyone else. You're going to be that reformer that makes everything right. And this angel is just really making you feel like, you know, you've been looking for your redemption. You've been looking for your, you know, for your path in life. And this angel seems to be telling you, you're on the right track. You will be the one that you will be a shining beacon in this world if you just stay the course.
Looks around at his boxes in the alleyway that he's sleeping in. Seems unnatural. All right. Gosh, who would I talk to out of the people? I don't know. I'll have to think about it. I'll have to consider.
That's pretty much it for this adventure that I have for you. Like I said, the next one's going to move forward the timeline only about a month. So we'll figure out, you know, what has happened in that month with the downtime rolls and your upkeep rolls at the beginning of next session. I don't want to do too much of a deconstruction of this one here. It's very interesting because there actually were combats written into this, but you guys actually did quite a bit to intentionally avoid most of them.
That's true. Because
Vigus was getting his hair cut.
There was a 9-foot tall construct with axes for hands, and I'm pretty sure Vigus would have just like run straight in and tackled that thing if he had been here.
His battle cry is dead.
I did like that, you know, you guys got a chance to use spells and skills in manners that weren't specifically combat related. I don't know if you guys enjoyed it, but I enjoyed it. I liked a lot of the careful approach, and I hope you guys enjoyed it. Let me know if you have anything, yay or nay, what you liked, what you didn't like about the session, but it was very interesting to me to see how it unfolded, and I appreciate all you guys playing. I had a lot of fun.
No, thanks for running it.
Thank you for running it. Thank you, everybody, for not killing the guard. I want to say that. Thank you.
Teapot does have Harvest Soul, but if he doesn't use it, it is released back into the wild within 4 hours. if he uses it, it goes back to the wild. So him, it's different than keeping salt in jar.
Holding them indefinitely and using them for currency, yes. So, yes, I hope everybody enjoyed tonight. I'm so used to running Thursday nights. I hope everyone enjoyed this morning. I hope you have a good rest of the weekend, and I will see you guys. Hopefully, we'll be good for next weekend. And thank you, everybody. If all of you hypothetical watchers out there that are watching on the internet, thank you guys, too. And I'm going to sign off now. Thanks, everybody, and I'll talk to you guys later.
See you.
Bye, everybody.
Hey, you.